sixth meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2016. Can I ask all those present to ensure that their electronic items are switched to flight mode so that they do not affect the work of the committee? Colleagues, can I move to agenda item number one, which is a decision in taking business in private? The question is that we take agenda items number 5 and 6 in private. Are we all agreed? We now move to agenda item number 2, which is evidence in the AGS report entitled the 2014-15 Audit of NHS 24, update on the management of the IT project, contract, sorry. I welcome our witnesses this morning, Paul Gray, the Director General of Health and Social Care, and Sarah Davidson, the Director General of Community Scottish Government. I understand that Mr. Gray would like to make a short opening statement.
Convener. Thank you for this invitation to give evidence to the Parliament Audit Committee. As the accountable officer for the health budget, I both understand and accept the committee's expressed anger and frustration at the very substantial delays and cost increases associated with the NHS 24 future programme, and I am very sorry indeed about this. It's not my intention today to seek to deflect criticism, nor to seek to tell the committee what it should think about the evidence it has before it already, or the evidence presented today. I do, however, want to provide the committee with as much information as I can in response to the questions it wishes to raise. And if either Sarah Davidson or I don't have the evidence or information readily to hand, we'll provide it as quickly as possible after the evidence session. I do want to assure the committee that we're taking the lessons learned from this to heart. We've taken a number of steps working with NHS 24 to ensure that they have access to both the leadership and skills required in order to bring the future programme into operation. The appointment of Angelina Foster as Chief Executive of NHS 24 has already been announced, and we've commissioned the Chief Nursing Officer, Professor Fiona McQueen, working with John Brown, the Chair of NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, and Jeff Ace, the Chief Executive of NHS Dumfries and Galloway, to form an advice and assurance group in support of the implementation plan for the future programme. I can also assure the committee that the NHS 24 Board Chair, Esther Roberton, and the Board as a whole are taking this very seriously indeed. NHS 24 have themselves enhanced the governance over the future programme and brought in additional expertise to ensure that it is now implemented as effectively as possible. I don't want to take up more time with the committee with my opening statement, so Convener Sarah Davidson and I will be happy to answer questions that the committee may wish to put.
Can I ask you, first of all, Mr. Gray, can you confirm what your arrangement and what the accountability structure is between yourself and NHS 24?
I'm the accountable officer for the National Health Service in Scotland, the chief executive of it. And I delegate the budgets to the accountable officers of the 22 boards, of which NHS 24 is one. So each of these boards has an accountable officer, and I delegate the budgetary responsibility for the running of the board to these accountable officers. But I am the accountable officer for the whole of the health budget.
Okay, so when there's a significant overspend of £41.5 million, as we've seen in the NHS 24, budget, you would take responsibility for that, would you?
I would accept that that responsibility falls to me. It falls to the accountable officer of NHS 24, but all the budget of the NHS in Scotland, ultimately, I am accountable for, and that's what I meant when I said I'm not going to try to deflect criticism. I accept that I am the accountable officer for the whole.
So, and how long have you been the accountable officer for?
I've been the accountable officer since December 2013.
Okay, so you could say over that period that you've had significant dealings with the NHS 24 period, because that seems to have been when the significant overspend started to develop. So what kind of action did you take during that time? And it doesn't look like it's been that significant given the overspends continued, don't they?
Well, I have, Convener, I have a detailed timeline, and I want to be mindful of the committee's time. How much detail would you like me to go into?
I'm more than happy to. I mean, it's a significant overspend of £41.5 million, so I would guess the public out there would want us to ensure that we take the time.
All right. Thank you, Convener. Can I start before I took up the role? Yeah. Is that okay? So, in July 2010, the NHS Scotland Capital Investment Group considered the programme initial agreement from NHS 24 and recommended that an outline business case should be prepared, noting that this was to be funded from within NHS 24's own resources. The approach of going through the capital investment group, in my view, was not the appropriate approach. I just make that point, and it would not happen now. In 16th December 2011, the full business case was considered by the Capital Investment Group and improved on the basis that NHS 24 engaged with other health boards. There was a contractual process undertaken, and in March 2012, NHS 24 signed contracts with Capgemini for software for approximately $20 million and for approximately $55 million for hardware with BT. So there's the $75 million starting point. In June 2013, there was a go-live date. It was delayed until September or October 2013, we'll say October, because of issues with the clinical content system. So that was the core clinical system supplied by a subcontractor to Capgemini, and the performance of the system, it basically did not work with 600 concurrent users. In August 2013, the Stage 4 Gateway Review was commissioned by NHS 24. They got an amber rating, but in October 2013, it was deferred again. In January 2014, I met the Chair and the Chief Executive of NHS 24 and sought to understand the issues. Shortly after that meeting, they then alerted me to the fact that they had discovered that not only was the system not performing, but the contract itself was incomplete. So that was January 2014. So in February 2014, we implemented our escalation process following their mid-year review. And that was the point at which we jointly commissioned Ernst & Young to give a report on the state of the system at that point. That report appeared and was finalised in March 2014, and in April 2014, the then Cabinet Secretary, Mr. Neil, met with the Chair and Chief Executive of NHS 24 to discuss the issues, and was provided at that point with substantial assurances on the steps being taken. However, I did not consider that they could proceed without an experienced programme director. We identified an experienced programme director, and that person was put in place in June 2014. Now, there's a lot of detail in between then and September 2015, which I'm happy to go through, but the core points of this are that in June 2014, they had neither a functioning system nor a contract. By August 2015, when Ian Crichton came in as the Chief Executive from National Services Scotland, they had worked during that period with Ian and others in NSS who had expertise, to the point where they had both a functional contract, one that could actually be enforced, and a system that provided the functionality that was required. And through that period, we ensured that they had the support they needed from NSS in order to get to that point. However, on the 7th and 8th of September 2015, they conducted what they call a system dress rehearsal. So basically, this is a full running of the system. That provided assurance from the staff who were operating it that it was working successfully. They had a successful test of business continuity, and they undertook a learning exercise from that. They switched on the scheduled care services on the 28th of October 2015, and that actually worked. The scheduled care element of this system worked. Now, there was a failure because of a breakdown in the external telecoms, but that was not to do with the core system. However, what became clear when they moved to the out-of-hours element, so there's the in-hours element, the scheduled care. What became clear when they moved to the out-of-hours element was that although it functioned effectively in testing, they had not invested enough in the training of the staff, so the staff were not sufficiently familiar with the system for it to operate at the speed that was required to give the turnaround to patients who were calling in. I went myself to NHS 24 to see the system in operation, so I can vouch personally for the fact that it works, but I can equally vouch for the fact that I saw the staff who had insufficient training struggling to operate the system at the rate at which it should be operated. Now, I'm just giving this completely honestly, convener. I see no point in trying to hide any of the facts here. And at that point, it was a clinically led decision that because, although the system was operating effectively, it could not be guaranteed that the turnarounds for ill patients would be provided, they would revert to the old system to carry out further testing and training. So I can give you a considerable amount of extra detail about what we did in that interim period if the committee finds it helpful, but that is the broad summary of 2 October 2015. Subsequent to that, the committee will have had access to the lessons learned report. They've heard the evidence from Ian Crichton and John Turner. We've now put Angelina Foster in place as the chief executive. Angelina has considerable experience in running organisations, particularly organisations which have gone through periods of difficulty, which is why she was selected. And one of the members of the assurance group, John Brown, his experience up until taking on his role as the chair of NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde was in the operation and turnaround of major call centres.
Okay, so and thank you for that. And we don't normally give witnesses such an extended period to respond, but I think given the concern and the significant sums that are referred to here, it's helpful. But what you referred to is that 3-year period when you were responsible as the accountable officer. But some of the elements of what you referred to, the actions that you took personally, one of them was to encourage them to employ a programme director, is that correct?
That's right.
So is that not something that a chief executive of NHS 24 could not have considered themselves? Does it need Paul Gray, the accountable officer for the NHS nationally, to refer to, you know, that kind of discussion that should take place? I mean, is that the level of detail in terms of your involvement?
Convener, not normally. If I would answer you frankly, not normally. I would expect that a chief executive of a health board would see that through. However, what we were able to help with was finding the right person from somewhere else in the NHS and expediting the process so that it would be done.
So when was the programme director appointed?
That was June 2014.
Yeah. So we still incurred significant losses despite the appointment of the programme director. So it didn't have the desired effect that you expected it to have, did it? Because the issue you're referring to as well was the programme director, and then you referred to staff training.
Yes.
So where's the connection there? I mean, you said that the programme was delivered, but there was an issue about the staff being trained to deliver the programme. So, you know, given that this appointment was made in 2014, it didn't have the desired effect, the recommendation that you made to the organisation, did it?
It had some of the desired effect, it didn't have all of it. So it had the desired effect, that plus all the other assistance we provided had the desired effect of getting us to having a viable contract and to having a system that functioned. However, may I speak about one of the lessons learned from this? It's in two parts, convener. And it's what in contract and certainly in IT systems is called optimism bias. The initial contract had a degree of optimism bias about it. So in other words, it was optimistic in its prediction of how complicated it would be and how much it would cost. It didn't include an allowance for inflation and it didn't include any contingency. Now, again, I believe both of these decisions to be wrong. So that's part one. And part two, if you test a system using your most experienced staff with one-to-one support from experts, it will inevitably be better and faster than it will when you use less experienced staff with fewer direct support. So for example, when I was in NHS 24 on one of the occasions, the ratio of support to staff was 25-1. So there's one person supporting 25 staff. So convener, that was a misjudgment by NHS 24 of the amount of training that would be needed, and they took too much confidence from the effective running and testing. The other point I will make is that the system was tested on one site. It runs across multiple sites. Systems that run across multiple sites never perform exactly the same on every site.
Can I just ask finally, in connection with this 40, so you've confirmed that you're the accountable officer.
Yes.
So ultimately you're responsible for the 41.5 million, is that correct?
So I'm responsible for the 13 billion that the NHS has. And however, the decisions to increase the funding for this programme were taken within NHS 24.
So, come on to
so I didn't allocate additional funding from central funds for this. We agreed brokerage, but that's to be repaid.
Yeah.
But I didn't go to the finance director for the NHS in Scotland and say, could you please give NHS 24 another 41 million.
You're responsible for the oversight of the leverage. I mean, you've been before the committee before.
Yes.
On other issues concerning leverage. But this is an organisation that's received 41.5 million pounds worth of, we've seen an overspend of 41.5 million. So this is an organisation that costs the public purse significant sums of money, not in the delivery of services out there in the front line that people see, but on the delivery of an overspend that the public actually don't see. And what they do see is cuts that have been made locally, and I can see it in my own health board that I represent, of £69 million. This is £41.5 million of overspend that could have been prevented. And all I'm asking you for you is, you're the accountable officer who's responsible for that. Do you not feel as if you've let down the Scottish Government in terms of the information that you provided to them to allow this overspend to take place over the last 3 years?
So I've been the accountable officer for 2 years and 2 months, but that doesn't alter the fact that ultimately I'm responsible for the total sum. The decisions that were taken in relation to what got us here were taken before I was the accountable officer, but nevertheless I am the accountable officer now, and I'm accepting responsibility.
Thank you. Amelia Scanlon.
Far be it from me to correct the convener in our second last meeting, but can I just ask Mr Gray, I note in Audit Scotland are now saying the final cost is likely to be £125 million. So given that we started off at 75.8, we've now gone up from 41 million to 49 million, 49.2 million overspend, is that correct?
That is potentially the overspend,
right,
depending on what the ultimate implementation.
It's just
date
that I don't
is.
Like to exaggerate, but I like to always present my case in fact. Can I just say the point the convener made about cuts? I looked at my emails this morning and there's a woman sitting up a Highland Glen that can't get 2 hours of home care a day from NHS Highland integrated care. That's about 20 quid a day. And I look at that and I think, oh, gee, you know, what can I do? And NHS Highland and NHS Council, they're up against the wall with the cuts. So do you understand, Mr Gray, and Ms Davidson as well, do you understand how angry people around this table feel when we've to look constituents in the eye and say, I'm sorry your mother can't get care to get her out of bed and back to bed in the morning and back to bed at night, 20 quid a day. And we'll come along here and we'll look at the cap reform, 70 million over budget, 50 million over budget here. It just slips off the tongue, you know. The reality is that the cuts out there are horrific. So do you understand just how angry and how frustrated members of this parliament are about the constant overspend on ICT? Do you really understand that?
I do, Ms Scanlon, and I sought to acknowledge that in my opening statement, and I meant it. I wasn't saying it for
effect. I appreciate that, and I've also always taken you at your word. You're one of the few that I do respect, Mr Gray. One of the very few. And I would just like to come back to you giving your word here a few years ago. So before I do that, can I look... We've been here before, of course. August 2012, managing ICT contracts. The Scottish Government was unable to provide advice That was Registers of Scotland disclosure and the Crown Office Prosecution Service. The Scottish Government were unable to provide advice. That wasn't didn't do too well. The Scottish Government also, wait a minute, this is June 2015, 3 years later, despite all the recommendations in 2012, the Scottish Government did not perform a skills gap survey across the public sector because we couldn't get staff for IT for 2 years. So worried were you about ICT and staff, the recommendations in 2012, it took you 2 years to do a skills gap survey. I then come on to your own letter, Mr. Gray. Your own letter to this committee, and this is October, this one is 2012. So we're 3.5 years ago. As the accountable officer, you tell us that a strategic review of current ICT skills availability within central government was to be carried out. And we all sat here naively taking you at your word. You then went on to say, Digital Future sets out plans for developing the workforce, developing ICT skills. You were working towards an action plan for the central government ICT workforce, and it would be in place by March. We then go on to June 2015, the next Audit Scotland report. And I don't know if they're as angry and frustrated as I am, but they keep coming up with reports and we're no further forward. So just finish on this point, convener. Part one, the strategic oversight. The Information Systems Investment Board was to oversee the implementation of the framework, but it didn't have sufficient information or capacity to perform this role effectively. It did not receive all the ICT investment and assurance information required from central government. So it's your role as accountable officer, but you're getting very little support from what I can see in nearly 5 years on this committee, with constant, we're not even looking at cap reform, 70 million over budget, but what you were setting out nearly 4 years ago was to make sure that the problems with the Registers of Scotland, which were minimal compared to this, would never happen again. So how can we take you at your word today?
And when I gave evidence to this committee in my previous role, I told you with as clearly as I could, and I told you honestly what I expected to happen. What actually happened, and Ms. Davidson may have further information she wishes to provide, what actually happened was that when the skills survey was done, it did not produce the results that were necessary to allow us to make a coherent approach from it. So we did something else.
It took you 2 years to do it.
I accept that, Ms. Scanlon. I'm not disputing what you've said. I'm simply saying that when we did this, it did not. The skills survey did not produce what was going to be effective in allowing us to tackle the problem. So we took a different approach. Would the committee wish to hear from Ms. Davidson on what that approach was?
Can we just convene her? Can I ask what Ms. Davidson, putting all the blame on you, Mr. Gray, but what responsibility has Ms. Davidson got here for this 50 million overspend?
On NHS 24?
Well, that's what we're talking
that
about.
That responsibility
today
is mine.
What's Ms. Davidson here for then? What's her role?
Well, she's here, if I may be simple about it, she's here because the committee asked her to come.
Well, what responsibility does she have? I mean, don't want to give you a rest from the questions. What responsibility does she have?
Sure. So I have responsibility for the assurance framework which governs the central government sector. It's a similar but different assurance framework to that which governs the NHS. and I have responsibility for the Digital Transformation Service, which supports the central government sector. And therefore, the skills survey, which you were alluding to a moment ago, is my responsibility, and the arrangements that we've put in place to respond to what we learned from the skills gap survey when we did it, which, as I absolutely acknowledge, last time I was here, didn't happen as early as it should have done,
are
my responsibility as well.
Right. What responsibility do you have, just so that we can get through this today? What responsibility did you have in terms of the £50 million overspend on NHS 24 ICT?
Nothing at all.
Right. Okay.
For the record, the committee's request for Ms Davidson to attend was in relation to the skills gap, and there was a discussion in a previous session in response to that.
Right. Okay. Back to Mr Gray.
There will be other questions for Ms Davidson.
Yes, I'm sure there will. Back to Mr Gray. Can I just say, I actually found it hugely concerning that you said that staff needed training. Are we saying that the ICT failure was partly due to the lack of staff training? Because we understand that the revised framework introduced in April 2015 provided clearer instructions and guidance, and the assurance framework that I think Ms Davidson was responsible for lacked clarity. So, I mean, what was this bit you were saying about the staff? Was the staff not fully trained? Did you not give them full training in the IT system?
In the future.
And I have one final question.
In the future system, particularly.
Well, there's that many systems, I don't know. The
NHS 24 future system, that was the training I was talking about.
Yeah.
The staff, all the staff who used the system were trained in using the system. The training was not sufficient, and the support that was provided when they were using it in live operation turned out to be insufficient. That's what happened in that particular case.
That's pretty disappointing. That also is what the Auditor General says. So can I just go over to the actual NHS 24? In April 2012, I've just got one question here which bothered me when I read this. April 2012, it was an NHS 24 member of staff who discovered that some of the negotiated sections were missing from the signed contract. Now, that's pretty poor, a member of staff.
Yeah.
It was nearly 2 years later before the chief exec and the director of finance was aware that what they had negotiated wasn't in the written contract. Was this member of staff or members of staff, did they employ the services of Pinsent Mason between April 2012 and January 2014 in order to renegotiate this contract and without the knowledge of yourself, their director of finance and their chief executive?
I don't know the answer to that question, Ms Cannon. I simply don't know the answer to that because I don't know the specific member of staff by name.
Are you aware that it was a member of staff that identified that what had been negotiated was missing from the written contract which was signed? Are you also aware that the Director of Finance and the Chief Executive of NHS 24 were not made aware of the missing terms in this contract, which led to the Court of Session?
Yes.
It led to having to pull out of the Court of Session. It led to a huge embarrassment for the government and indeed the civil service in Scotland, because at the end of the day, Capgemini were right about the contract, and they were, it would appear, they were fulfilling the contract in the terms of what was written.
So I'm aware that the knowledge of the deficiencies in the contract was with staff in NHS 24 sometime before the chair, the chief executive and the chair were
nearly
told.
2 years.
I can't say that absolutely, Ms Scanlon, but I don't dispute it.
Well, Audit Scotland have said it.
Well, I'm quite happy to accept that. But what I am aware of is that the chair and the chief executive did not know until January 2014. I met them early in January 2014, and at that point we were talking about the deficiencies in the performance of the system. I met them again in January 2014 when they had become aware that the contract itself was incomplete. So I can confirm absolutely that they didn't know until then, and I'm quite happy to accept Audit Scotland's evidence that someone in NHS 24 knew in 2012.
Sorry, just my final question. You know, in terms of project management, and you sit here in all honesty as the accountable officer, now the way I see it is not only did you not know that part of the negotiated contract, verbally negotiated, was not in the written contract, they never did a page-by-page check. So NHS 24 didn't even know what was in the written contract that they signed. Are you not concerned that not only did you not know that they were running towards a 50 million overspend, the Director of Finance didn't know, Chief Executive didn't know, and a member of staff employed a leading legal company to try and negotiate this contract that you were unaware of, and the officers, Director of Finance and Chief Exec were unaware of? Does that not cause you a bit of concern?
It causes me grave concern.
Yes. And are you sorting that out then? In future?
Well, Convener, I could give a substantial answer to that if you wish, or I'm happy to be guided as to the time of the committee.
If you give a very as brief a response as you can give with as much detail as possible.
An organisation in which a member of staff knows something of that significance and does not escalate it immediately to the board is a dysfunctional organisation. Yeah. Yeah. It would be my concern, therefore, to ensure that no organisation for which I am responsible it behaves in such a way that a member of staff feels they cannot escalate an issue of that significance to the board. That's as brief an answer as I can.
Thank you.
That's fine, thank you.
Richard Simpson.
What I find interesting is actually looking at the material we've had today from Lee Evans about IT in response to other questions I've had, in which he says that the NSS has, I think he says, considerable experience. NHS organisations already work collaboratively in commissioning, procurement and implementation of IT with an established e-health governance framework. Now, if we have an established governance e-health framework, what was it doing in relation to this particular contract? Because one of the problems, I think, has been, and is still with the NHS as a whole, is that we have allowed NHS 24, and indeed all the 22 boards when commissioning IT, go off and do it themselves, and they don't have the experience to be able to do it. And the result is, for example, that the Health Committee's report in 2010 on clinical portals, we're still 5 years on, having a major problem with the access of clinical portals between different boards. I mean, my questions to the government, which have been answered on that, demonstrate it quite clearly. Mm. So, you know, we have had for, you know, as long as I've been in this parliament, and I include the first period as well, a pretty dysfunctional system for IT procurement. And I'm not convinced that we've got any better on this. Now, again, and the other point I want to make and question on this is, why do we have to employ Pinsent Mason to do the legal work for this particular contract when Lee Evans states, and again in his report to us, that the NSA, National Services Scotland, has considerable procurement expertise and works with on behalf of NHS boards, providing, for example, contract management support and legal services. So we've spent £500,000 of government money on a private firm whose software didn't upload the tender document properly, who then advised somebody in the board that this was something that was quite common, and I find that alarming. But they said, oh no, this happens all the time. We'll just have a memorandum of understanding, it'll be okay. And then repeat the mistake a second time. Now, why are we employing external people in that way? I think that's my first question. Why have we not? I mean, the government is a pretty big procurer of IT in Scotland, one way or another, with all the different bits, not just NHS, but all the different bits. Why have we not got a core legal service, legal framework, a core expertise in IT that allows every programme of procurement to be directed to an oversight board which actually examines it at every step of the way. And that includes call centres, by the way, because we've got call centres and police, call centres and fire board, call centres and the NHS. So why have we not got that expertise?
Can I just ask colleagues to try and keep questions as succinct as possible, and then we'll make sure we get answers.
Thank you, convener. Dr. Simpson, what happened should not have happened. There isn't a nicer way of putting it than that. The NHS 24 should have used the expertise that is available in NSS, and we have now instituted with the chairs and the chief executives an approach which we call Once for Scotland, which says if you're going to do certain things, this is the way you do them. You don't go off and just make a personal choice about how it might suit. You are obliged to make use of the skills, the capability and the experience that is available. And if you choose not to, then the accountable officer for the board has to explain why. Now, there may be circumstances in which there isn't sufficiency of resource available centrally. The other thing, of course, NSS can do is to procure that resource through their contracts. So, how do I put this? I sought to persuade NHS 24 to use NSS, and I quickly gave up on that approach and simply told them. So that's about as brief an answer as I can give you.
Well, that's very helpful, but it's the fact that the boards can go and do things themselves. I mean, I know we've tried to prevent massive expenditure on a centralised record system, for example, because look what happened in England. Yeah. They wasted billions. So we've avoided that, but we've now got a fragmented system that is totally dysfunctional as between boards. For, you know, if you're in one board, you're probably okay. But if you have to go from Fife to Tayside, the Tayside clinicians do not have access to basic information like the Sky lab stuff. You know, and this is 5 years on from the telehealth report by the health committee. So, you know, the fact that you stepped in and did that is very welcome. But, you know, should the boards not have to account to you as the accountable officer at every step of the way if they're not going to go down, for example, the 14th board that is not procuring track care? One board, you know, why is that board being allowed to do that and have a system that's not compatible with everybody else? How do you, my question is, how are you controlling this? What reporting mechanism is there to the centre at each step of the way that prevents us having a dysfunctional system?
So, in January of this year, the responsibility for the e-health programme overall transferred to John Connachan, the Chief Operating Officer. That was a deliberate step on my part to take it into a point where it's under the aegis of the Chief Operating Officer. So in other words, it's concerned with the operation of the health service as a whole. And I've asked John Connachan to provide me by the end of March with an analysis of all the major programmes that are going on and the risks associated with them, and particularly with reference to the points I made to the convener earlier, those in which we think there may be some degree of optimism bias. In other words, we think, you know, we hope it will work, but we're not absolutely sure, or we hope it will cost this much, but, you know, experience tells you that it probably won't. When I was a member of the Infrastructure Investment Board in the Scottish Government, one of the starkest pieces of advice we got via SFT, Scottish Futures Trust, was that in some capital buildings programmes, there is an optimism bias of 40%. So in other words, they underestimate the outturn cost by about 40%. In IT programmes, and I was the Chief Information Officer for the Scottish Government, in IT programmes, it was my analysis that the optimism bias ran in the range of 20 to 25%. We routinely had to allow about 20 to 25% contingency. So we did. We built it in. We didn't just say, well, that's a pity and we'll wait and see what happens. So there is some evidence here of what is likely to be the case.
My last question, convener, is about the Gateway report.
Yeah.
Now, you know, when I asked the question in the chamber, I'm told this is not a government report. So can somebody explain to me what Gateway reports are about And this particular Gateway report said this is an example of good practice or best practice. Now, I know there was an Amber Alert, but an Amber Alert was related to possible delays, whereas actually it was contained in that report that this was an example of best practice. What are these Gateway reports? Were they not the mechanism by which the government's central body actually took a look at what was going on with a project being run by an individual board or indeed other organisations out there and said, yes, this is on time, this, the optimism bias is acceptable, the programme is being developed appropriately, training's been put in place that's correct. What was the extent of the Gateway report? What are they?
The Gateway report at that stage, as I understand it, looked at the governance and the contractual arrangements that were in place. On the face of it, that appeared sufficient. I see, convener, to answer this question cautiously, because there have been a number of Gateway reports that have been excellent and insightful, and I don't want to undermine the Gateway process in the eyes of the committee, because I think it's a valuable process. However, for a programme of this complexity, being done once every 15 years, my analysis is, and I have conveyed this, that you would need a review or a report done by individuals who had experience in similar systems of similar complexity. And I do not think that that was the case in this particular review report. So if a Gateway report is to make sense, then it has to be carried out by people of sufficient experience, seniority and capability. It's also a process that runs over about 2 days. And again, there's a question in my mind over whether on something of this scale and complexity that is going to do any more than simply give you a top level set of assurances. So I think the points you're making about deeper assurance are quite germane in this context.
That's great. Could I just ask for information to come back later? And that is, could we have a note from either Sir Davidson or Paul Gray on all the costs of external consultants like PricewaterhouseCoopers and Ernst & Young? I know the Ernst & Young one wasn't given to us in the latest report, but you know, we spent $750,000 on external consultants on this one project. Could we get a list of the costs of external consultants of this sort that have had to be brought in on any IT projects? Now, I know they're not all NHS projects, but could you relay this back to the appropriate information officer and ask for that information
to be provided to the committee? We can do that, Dr. Simpson. Convener, if it helps the committee, the cost of the Ernst & Young report was £58,700.
Sure,
I'm happy to provide that information now. I would also ask that, should the committee want information on every single IT project in the public sector in Scotland, that will be a fairly massive piece of work. So is there any context the committee would wish to put around that? We'll do it if that's what the committee wants, but I just want to alert them to the fact that that would be very substantial.
Yeah, we'll come back to you with that and discuss
okay.
it.
Okay. Thank you.
We'll come back to the full details on that. Okay. Combity.
Thank you, Mira. Looking at the issues around NHS 24's IT problems, I mean, I personally don't think we can look at this really in isolation. It's part of a broader issue about ICT procurement within the government, and I'm sure our successor committee will be pursuing that. There's all sorts of problems here about industry shortage of skills and how the whole thing's managed. But looking forward, we're looking back at all the problems, but we've still got a service to deliver to the public. Can you give us some assurances as to the delivery of this service, what the milestones will be, and what reassurance we have that they'll be adhered to?
It's a very fair question, Mr. Beattie. I would like to allow the incoming Chief Executive, Angelina Foster, to review the lessons learned and come to view with the support structures that we've put in place of the likely implementation programme for this. There's nothing that I've heard so far that would take me away from the proposition that this system should be implemented by the summer, but I would like to give the Chief Executive the opportunity to review what has been done so far and to assure herself, given that we've put some expertise in to allow her to get that assurance, before giving absolutely fixed points in time by which certain things will happen. I hope the committee would understand that that's a reasonable stance to take.
With hindsight, is this the right system? Did we choose the right system for NHS 24? Is it over complex?
Well, these are perhaps two separate questions. So what will the system... Let me give you a brief description of what the system will do as a way of saying that I do think it is a suitable choice. It will allow more emphasis to be placed on triage rather than consultation. So in other words, patients will be fully assessed and sent to the most appropriate service or for information as quickly as possible. So it will speed that up. It will reduce the need for repeat questioning and duplication, which really, I have to say, does annoy folk if they have to, you know, they answer a whole set of questions and then they go back and virtually have to answer them all again. So we will reduce that. There'll be a single sign-on for all staff to all the systems they require. It'll reduce the time needed for a call and make it safer. And the knowledge management system, which they use to signpost the services, will give real-time information on what services are available at the actual time of the call. So in other words, you won't signpost a patient to something that isn't available at that point in the day. So that will be an improvement. There'll be a single patient record for all services, so NHS 24 staff will immediately know if a patient has made an earlier call to the service, but in a different place. So that will be drawn together. And so there'll be improvements to the patient journey, and it also provides a modern IT platform on which new digital health and care services can be provided, such as video-supported services, which just couldn't be done under the existing platform. So... Yes, it is an appropriate system for NHS 24.
Is it a system that's been built from the ground up? In other words, have we sort of invented it ourselves? Or did we take advantage of other systems, comparable perhaps, that might be available elsewhere?
So, the Arezzo core of the system is a clinical triage system, and that was not built from the ground up, but it had to be adapted to fit within all the other telephony and scheduled care services. So it's been built not quite from scratch. It's been built using components that already existed, but it is unique to NHS 24.
Given that there's presumably a comparable system south of the border, was it looked at as a possibility to simply transfer that here?
I can't answer that, Mr. Beattie, but I'm happy to get that information for the committee if they'd find it helpful.
Now, you yourself, Mr. Gray, I think said you came in as the accountable officer towards the end of 2013.
Yeah.
At what point did you become aware of a problem with NHS 24?
January 2014. So about, it was 5 weeks or so after I took the post.
When were the Scottish ministers advised there was an issue?
Let me just go through my timeline. Well, they were certainly advised by me as soon as I knew, so I can give you that assurance. What they had been told before that, so there was, for example, the Stage 4 Gateway Review, which gave an amber alert. Now, that was August 2013, and that would certainly have been drawn to the attention of ministers, but I'm not about to try to invent points at which ministers were told. I can simply tell you that I told them in January 2014, but I cannot imagine that senior colleagues would not have told ministers before, and indeed they would have known about the Gateway report. That could not have been known.
There's a great deal being talked about the increase in cost of this, and indeed it's very substantial. You said that there was an optimism within IT contracts of about, was it 25%, thereabouts?
That was what roughly when I was doing it, yeah.
And you said there was no contingency built into this at all?
No.
What's the 25% optimism built, constructed from? Where does it come from?
It's basically That analysis, when I was Chief Information Officer, was based on reviewing a large number of systems from small to great, and comparing the outturn expenditure with the planned expenditure. Some of that, of course, is because the specification changes after the contract is let, so that clearly increases the cost. But that was an average that we worked to. So we would tend, if a program came forward with no contingency, we would send that back and say, if you haven't thought about contingencies here, you haven't done a proper business case.
Given the overrun costs, and presumably that overrun's being met by brokerage.
Yes.
What are the implications for future service delivery, funding? Can that be coped with?
Well, it can, Mr. Beattie, but I mean, the convener and the vice convener have made important points about the fact that this is £50 million that isn't being spent on something else, and I'm accepting that point. But it is not going to bring the NHS in Scotland to its knees, but it is £50 million that, had it not been spent on this, could have been spent on something else.
Thank you, Convener. Just on your very final point there, Mr. Gray, and thank you for your frankness this morning. You say it won't bring the NHS to its knees, but I was told last night that NHS Shetland are facing cuts to primary care, in other words, to GP practices, of £300,000. That's going to be pretty damaging. This is £50 million that could have helped Highlands, the convenience constituency, all of our constituencies. So, you know, there are some things that will be brought to their knees because of this failure, won't there?
Well, it would... It's £50 million that could have been spent on something else, Mr. Scott. I'm not going to try to argue my way around that. It's not that we took money from the primary care budget or took money from another board. It's effectively £50 million that NHS 24 itself could have spent on other things. So it hasn't actually removed money from other places.
On the £50 million itself, could you just clarify whether this overspend is on capital expenditure? Is it on BT and Capgemini, or is it on training? Because I was a bit puzzled when you made your initial remarks. Yeah. You obviously highlighted rightly the failures of training. So is this 50 million or whatever figure it currently is it split between those budgets, or how would you like to break that down?
It's largely contractual payments. It's not the training element of this is not a significant element. And again, if the committee would like a detailed breakdown, I'm more than happy to provide that to you.
I'm sure that would be very helpful. And the other thing I just wanted to clarify, you've mentioned very fairly the new chief executive who you have appointed. Is that person, is that a permanent appointment, or is she coming in for a temporary period of time so as to, as you I think pointed out, take care of the troubles that are currently in this organisation?
So the appointment of Angelina Foster is to the end of this calendar year. That was deliberate rather than just, you know, a happenstance. Once the body NHS 24 is through the current set of issues it has and has a successfully implemented system, it seems to us and to the chair of NHS 24, that's the time then to seek a permanent chief executive once you've got a stable organisation. What we've done at the moment is to bring in a chief executive who's experienced in taking organisations through a period of difficulty, but then you'll need a particular skill set for a steady state organisation, which will be somewhat different.
That's fair enough. Is it your expectation that the new system will be operational in June, as we were told earlier?
I've said the summer, so I'm being slightly less...
Civil servant summer is a long, many months. Well, I seem to remember using that term in the past as well.
Well, my wedding anniversary is on the 3rd of September, so it's always summer then.
So we're going to take it might be September, it might be operational.
No, I'm not trying to give the committee a hint. I'm simply saying that I expect, you know, that the system will go live in the summer. I think it's very important that it does, Mr. Scott, because... we'll come to the winter and the busy period and all the pressures that places, and we really don't want to be an implementation.
The reason I asked about the summer was, again, if the chief executive is leaving and you're recruiting in the autumn for a new appointment at Christmas or the new year, that, as you rightly just said, is the busiest time, is it not, for the whole NHS service. Is that the right time to be doing it because of that pressure?
Well, I don't think what we'll do is create a further burden on NHS 24 if a new chief executive is appointed and can't start until January, we're certainly not going to take the current one away.
Okay, understand that. Thank you.
Okay, Nigel Dunn.
Thank you very much. And good morning, colleagues. I'd like to take this sort of up a level to ask some of the questions which are occurring to me. And if I can start with you, Mr. Gray, again, you talked about, you implied, I think, just now, that it's perfectly possible that somebody would bring forward a project that didn't include contingencies. Now, sorry, I as a factory engineer 30 years ago wouldn't have dreamt of putting forward a proposal that didn't have the relevant contingencies. It only wouldn't have contingencies if it was something which was actually buyable off a shelf and I could take off a price list. Why are we in a position where people are putting forward projects without contingencies?
I don't suppose it would be sufficient for me to say, well, I wouldn't, because I wasn't a factory engineer, but I was an IT professional, and I would never put forward a project without some level of contingency that I had assessed properly. Why does it happen? Well, it happens for three reasons. Firstly, I think people feel that it's very important to get all their estimates right first time, and we all know that that doesn't happen. The second reason is because I think we are somewhat guilty of making people produce business cases which aren't really the business case. And what do I mean by that? The business case for this new system, I've described some of the benefits it provides, but the business case for this system is also because the old system is going to run out of support in a certain, pretty soon. And frankly, if you're trying to construct a discounted cash flow that says it will produce this much saving over this much time, you're always being pushed to make the cost as lean as possible so that the saving can be seen to emerge as quickly as possible. I think we need to get more sensible about business cases and say the business case for this, is your building is going to fall down if you don't do something, so you need to do something. It's not because you'll save £20 million over a period of time. So that's the second reason. And the third reason is because I think we place undue weight on very precise numbers. You really need to look at a system in the round and look at the evidence that you have about what has happened in the past when people have tried to implement systems like this. You have to look at the cohort of people whom you're serving and the cohort of people who you're going to have to train and think very hard about what they know and what it's going to take to get them into the new system. If I may say in passing, one of the things that the training didn't cover was what the system didn't do. Now, that might sound a very odd thing to say, but actually, if you're used to a system that does one thing when you press button B, and all of a sudden when you press button B, that doesn't happen, that's a bit of a shock. So you need to, all of that, I think, requires you to think in a very contextual way about what it is you're trying to implement. And once you've done that, you come away from what will the software cost and what will the hardware cost to what will the total cost of implementing this system be? And then you get a much better estimate of what the real cost is.
Mr. Gray, can I say thank you for that exposition? I'm wondering whether there's somebody listening who could just tidy that up, write it on one side of a piece of paper, because it will get there, and send it to every single civil servant, because you have just expanded actually how you get some intelligence into it. I'm sorry, that is how we should do these things, and why do your colleagues not understand that? What's the point of having a cash flow analysis if you haven't even built in the contingencies? I mean, sorry, that's obvious to those of us who do these things. Why does the civil service not understand that is a question which you can't answer, but maybe Alison Stafford's listening. I guess my next one, convener, is actually, sorry, Alison, forgive me, Sarah, I apologise, wrong name.
I think Ms. Davidson does understand. I will leap to her defence.
Well, okay, I'm sorry, and I picked the wrong name off my list, I do apologise. Can I come back though to the general issue of governance, because, and I don't want to get remotely personal about this, but we've been through a period, and I've been through a period on this committee listening to people explaining how a lot of projects haven't worked very well, and of course there have been lots of projects that have worked well, and actually we haven't covered them off, which is part of your point about what things don't do.
And we've been through a diagram which I think had 9 different boards on it, as I recall, for the governance of these things. Now, I'm not the only colleague on this committee who's commented that maybe that can't be a very good way of operating, but what were the governance organisations doing while this was going wrong? And what have the governance organisations learned so that this doesn't happen again?
Do you want to take a point just before, and then I'll take the point more generally?
Yeah. So I think, I mean, what were the governance organisations doing? Well, what were they doing before I got here? I can't speak in detail for that, but what I have said, and I repeat, is that the way that this was put through governance was not right. So actually, it wasn't touching the right bits of the governance organisation. That was part of the problem. However, what the governance did in February 2014 was to act in relation to what we call our ladder of escalation. That's the process we have for escalating things. And that ladder of escalation was what brought about ultimately the appointment of a new programme manager and the restoration of the contractual position and the fact that they got to a system which at least functionally operated. So the governance, from 2014, did step in and did produce some results. It did not produce a system that functioned in November 2015, and I'm not trying to glide away from that. But the governance was there, and when it operated, it produced a result. But because it started off in the wrong place, it wasn't touching the right points of the governance as it went along. Now, there was internal governance within NHS 24, and I think the committee has already explored some of that, and Audit Scotland have reported on it. But one of the things I think I've already mentioned is I'm very anxious to understand if there are systems being developed locally which have national significance but are not touching the sides of the governance in the way that they should, and that's why I've asked John Conachan to do what I've asked him to do.
If I could pick that up and make a more general point, albeit that health projects and central government projects are managed within different frameworks, the thing which they have in common, as Mr. Gray's explained, is the responsibility and assurance for projects running through the senior responsible officer to the accountable officer. And that's the same both in the central government sector and in the NHS. One of the things which we have increased our focus on the central government sector, and I think we could take from what we've heard this morning the same is the case in health, in the light of the recent Audit Scotland reports, has been the need for escalation quickly through those systems so that we use the governance frameworks well, and indeed within central government use the assurance framework to act immediately if problems are flagged and not to leave those to be dealt with by individual organisations within their own assurance. And that's the way in which the broader governance system can support the assurance that's taking place within individual organisations.
Yeah, okay. Can I just dig into this? Because if I'm hearing you both are right, you're suggesting that governance is something which exists and the problem is pushed up to it. And it's the responsibility of those who are aware of an issue to escalate it. Would it not be altogether rather safer if governance was seen as being an activity that went down and periodically dug deep enough to actually check? Because surely that's really what governance is about. You know, we don't want to wait till the plane falls out the sky before we check whether the routine maintenance of the engines is good enough.
No, absolutely. And I would say within individual organisations, certainly within the central government sector, I would expect the governance of an individual project to be doing exactly what you describe, and that providing things are going well, that type of iterative kind of virtuous circle governance ought to keep things on track. The strengthening that we've put into the assurance system over the last couple of years has been in order to pick up things where that is not working as virtuously as it should, so that it doesn't just remain hidden within the local governance, but is escalated to the senior accountable officer or to ministers if necessary, so that action can be taken. And part of what we want to do is to build a culture where organisations and that internal governance that you describe is far more comfortable with flagging up the fact that they've got difficulties and need help, rather than thinking they have to resolve things all themselves.
Yeah, okay, but that's working against human nature, which is not about to change, I would suggest. Can I in that context, though, just ask you, I've got a letter here which is unrelated to this, but we will be talking about later, about a performance board which has been set up by the government, and you will be aware of that. I'm looking down that list, nothing personal about any of this at all, but mostly it's directors, and there are two non-executive directors. I've no idea who they are, but I suspect they're what we would tend to describe as usual suspects. To what extent is there really non-executive challenge within the organisations which you represent, which are other important parts of the Scottish Government, in such a way that virtuous circles are allowed to be virtuous circles, but somebody's actually asking how virtuous this is, whether people really are asking the right questions or whether they're just on the golf course together?
I don't play golf, which is a mercy for many, I have to say. But so I would say that if I take the specific of NHS 24, believe me, the non-executive directors are now exceedingly focused on their task, and they've also been significantly refreshed. There are new members of the board, I can say from personal experience that they're taking that very seriously indeed. You ask a very fair question. You know, how do we get the necessary level of external challenge so that we're not sitting comfortably assuming it's all going fine when in fact Rome is burning? And the answer to that is, we do go through pretty careful selection processes to appoint non-executive directors. I've certainly been faced with some pretty uncomfortable challenge in terms of what I do and how I go about it, and quite properly so. I don't want to get into the sort of naming names, but I can assure you that, for example, in the Health and Wellbeing Audit and Risk Committee, I have a number of non-executive colleagues who are completely fearless in asking questions and are not too worried about whether I like them or not. So, and I think that's absolutely right. And in the broader sphere of the performance board, I don't think the non-executive directors who have been asked to take part in that will do so in a sort of automatic or anodyne way.
No, I wasn't trying to pick up on that. I guess my point about that, though, was simply that there are only two of them. Yeah. No, sorry, you could be the finest available, and you're seriously outnumbered. You can quite easily get just overwhelmed. Yeah.
The one thing I would also add is that, again, in the central government sector, but now going to be available to health, the investment which we've been making in the Digital Transformation Service provides other individuals who can stand separate from executive responsibility within an individual body, but bring quite a deep expertise in the structure and delivery of digital transformation programmes and IT projects, and are able to ask the kind of questions, or to support non-executives and ask the kind of questions that can get to the heart of the matter. So I think that's another contribution we can make to that analysis.
Have you reflected at all on the general governance structure on which we've commented before, which did seem to be very, very complicated? It suggested to me from experience elsewhere that there will be people having meetings because there were just so many people that had to have a meeting in order to decide when the next meeting was going to be.
I think there's an important distinction between the governance of individual projects and programmes and the governance of the government's overarching digital transformation strategy. And the latter is about ensuring alignment. So, for example, the overall Digital Transformation Sponsor Board ensures that all sectors across the public sector are developing public services in a digital way which aligns with the vision for that. And that's a quite different task from the governance of individual projects and programmes. And I am satisfied that the former does not contaminate the latter. In other words, that the landscape that's required to do the more reflective piece of alignment is not getting in the way of good delivery and management of individual projects. However, I did say, I think, when I was before this committee in the autumn, and I think the Permanent Secretary iterated at Christmas time, that we are going to review the overall operation of the assurance framework and necessarily the governance that goes with it in the spring and summer of this year. And absolutely, we'll take stock on that and take the views of those involved in it as to whether they feel that it genuinely hinders or helps them achieve what they're trying to do.
Okay. David Torrance.
And that's my question is towards Sarah Davidson. future public sector ICT contracts, how are we going to ensure that the skill and the expertise are there so we're not back in the same boat 2 years now sitting in front of this committee? And it was interesting, he actually says there, flagged up when they need help. Is it not that we should have the correct procedures in place and expertise in place at the beginning of these contracts rather than come running to flag up that we need help and we're in trouble?
Absolutely. And the way in which the assurance framework and the transformation service, which is the skills service, work together is intended to do exactly that. So in the central government sector, but I'm sure there's a parallel process in health, as soon as anybody or a part of central government decides that it needs a particular project, they require to engage with the Office of the Chief Information Officer within government and to have their initial proposition assessed by that office in order to determine whether the budget looks right, again picking up all the points we discussed earlier about contingency and others, whether the right skills are in place to deliver a project of the scale and complexity that's envisaged, and whether the timescales that are envisaged are realistic. And if any of those points are deemed inadequate, then the project will get an amber rating, and if more than one of those points is deemed inadequate, it will get a red rating. And that triggers the active involvement of the Office of the Chief Information Officer working along with the Project and Programme Management Centre of Expertise and the Digital Transformation Service to remedy, or to more correctly, to support the SRO and his or her team and the accountable officer in remedying that. And again, I think when I was last at the committee, the Digital Transformation Service was only in its first weeks of operation, but already in the quarter since then, it has staffed up considerably, has applied exactly that type of support to projects at inception stage, and is currently, I think, working with five organisations at early business case stage to identify the skills that they need. And if they need skills, the Digital Transformation Service will go and help them get those from the market. So that is absolutely what we need to be doing. I suppose the final thing I would say, envisaging as we are at the moment the increased responsibility that comes with the devolution of additional powers, some of which will require significant IT and digital capability, we're already thinking now about the particular skills and indeed the types of individuals that we will need to find from the market to ensure that we can deliver those well. And in doing so, we absolutely learn the lessons of projects that have both gone well and not gone so well in the recent past.
Thank you.
Okay. Sure.
Thank you. Mr. Gray, earlier on in your comments, you spoke about the staff training being insufficient. As somebody, before I was elected to Parliament, I worked in a private sector organisation, and there was a huge change that took place in terms of software implementation. It was quite a feat. Our department doubled in size when software is supposed to facilitate and make things that bit easier. But the thing that really struck me then, and also something about this, was just in terms of actually the staff accessing the training, and the particularly also with the numbers of people who work in NHS 24. Not everyone's going to be able to go maybe at the particular allotted time. So were there any particular issues that NHS 24 actually faced in terms of staff actually accessing the training? Whether maybe kind of did, if somebody or if individuals didn't fully understand the software, were they able to go back on multiple occasions to get further information and assistance?
I think it's a fair question, Mr. McMillan. I think my understanding of what happened is it wasn't so much an issue of being able to access the training itself, but the amount of time that was provided, and then what they called floor walkers, the on-floor support. So if in training, you've got 3 hours, just let's say, to come to terms with a new system, it probably feels okay at that point. But then when it comes to live running, so for example, if in testing, and they did do this, you've got people as actors saying, describing their symptoms. It is frankly rather different when you've got someone on the end of the phone in a live situation describing symptoms that you know are very serious and need urgent attention, and you're struggling with this bit of software in front of you. So I think it was more to do with the amount of the training, and as I've said earlier, the fact that colleagues needed to know what the system didn't do as well as what it did do, And also, the amount of support provided on the floor was underestimated. So if you took all these things together, that's what created the effect.
Okay. So certainly going forward with the system, I would take it that that these issues will be fully addressed, and also particularly with any new members of staff who do come into the organisation, will that be fully taken on board in terms of A, their competence, their IT competence at that point, as well as any additional training that they require.
Certainly, and I mean, that's why I want to give Angelina Foster time to ensure that she's satisfied that there is a space allowed for all these issues to be addressed. Perversely, it might actually be easier for someone coming in afresh who's never used the old system, because they won't have approaches and ways of doing that are aligned to the old system. They'll simply become familiar with the new and go ahead with that from scratch. So, but yes, I am very clear that NHS 24 have a strong commitment to ensuring that people who come in to use their systems are properly trained in them. This is at times genuinely a matter of life and death. It cannot be left to chance.
Just on that point, it just struck me that with the new system that's being introduced, is that being asked to do the same job as a previous system but just a bit differently, or is it being asked to do something totally different?
It's a bit of both. So, for example, I spoke about the reduction in repeat questioning and duplication. I mean, that's doing what the old system did, but just doing it better. But the switch from emphasis to from consultation to triage, I think, is a new approach, and it certainly has a strong clinical support. The real-time information on the services that are available at the time of the call, that's a new feature. And the single patient record is also a new feature. So it's doing some things better, but it's also doing some things differently.
Okay. And my final question, convener, just it's in terms of the paper that we received, and it's under recommendations 6.7, and it's the second bullet point in terms of the executive management team should secure effective call centre implementation support from both Capgemini and other independent sources to support the future programme. In terms of the other independent sources, who do you envisage they would actually be? Would it maybe be from other private sector providers, where there's clearly going to be a kind of high volume of calls on a daily basis, or would it be maybe from kind of other areas of the public sector?
Well, I can give you two examples of what they've actually done. So, they have just recruited someone with expertise in delivering call centre implementations on a contract to work with the programme director, so that she has a direct personal access to that level of expertise. And I also mentioned that John Brown, the chair of NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, has direct personal and very recent expertise in that area, which is why he's part of the assurance. So they have assurance, if you like, from a public sector expertise angle, and also from a private sector expertise angle, and that is in place. That's not something we're hoping will happen.
Okay. Right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, convener. Good morning. One of the things you said earlier on, Mr. Gray, about the method that the contracts are financed and the likes, has kind of got me a little bit animated in my thinking, if you like, particularly that around optimism bias and the contingencies. It takes me back. David Torrance and Nigel Dawn have both asked quite a lot of the questions, and you've answered them, some of the things I was thinking along the lines of. It takes me back to the point of absolute clarity of what is being required, and what you said earlier on about an acceptance that there'll be spec changes within any particular programme, which obviously we think in terms then about taking your contingency and working within that. But of course, if the optimism bias is so low, your contingency really means nothing. So it comes into the fact, who's keeping a hold of what you're actually asking a contractor to produce for you? in terms of the end product of what will be used? And who is actually keeping a hold on the decision of what specifications and when are being changed? Because it would seem to me that unless somebody is sitting there absolutely aware that there is a change in what is being asked and the specs that are coming in, the difficulties technically, let alone the cost overruns that would necessarily happen. Who's actually keeping their hand on this? Because it seems to me that every time there's an ICT project that comes up, there's a lack of knowledge surrounding what's being asked for and also, you know, how it's changed from beginning to end.
Let me try to be brief in my response. It's the responsibility, ultimately, not just in NHS 24, but in any programme of this size and style, it's the responsibility of the programme director to ensure that any changes that are asked for are actually required. And why I say that is this, Mr. Keir. Sometimes when you get through the process of system design and then you see it in operation, people say, well, wouldn't it be nice if it just did such and such a thing? Well, actually, it might well be nice, but it wasn't in the original specification, and paying more money for something that would be nice is not good use of public funds. However, you might get to a point, and I'm using a deliberately invented example here, you might get to a point where you have a clinical system that allows you to record three conditions, and you say, but actually, in practice, people turn up with more than three conditions, so what happens if they've got four or five? Now, that would be a necessary change. If you'd asked for something to record a certain number of conditions and it turned out that wasn't going to work in practice, that's a required change. But each change ought to be the subject of a change control notice. So, in other words, it's not simply somebody on a whim saying, I would like it to do this. And that change control notice should go through the governance framework so that the programme director ultimately can be assured that the change is both necessary and cost-effective. The other thing it's important to do is to bundle up changes, not to do them piecemeal, because that it hugely adds to cost if you just do a little change and then another little change. And actually, if you don't do them in a bundle, you can have adverse interactions between the changes, which create situations that you just didn't want. So it's very important that that's properly controlled, both from expenditure of public funds and also from the point of view of not undoing the good that has been done in developing the system.
So would just take me to one final question then after that would be, how confident are we that the people who are in place going through from procurement right away through the management, through the gateways reviews, are the right people to be doing those jobs? And I know you've answered earlier on about the, they're looked at carefully and all the rest of it, but for these particular problems that we're facing, the 41 million overrun, are we really sure we've got the right people in place that can identify what you've described?
Well, I've looked at this very carefully, Mr. Keir. I actually met the person that they're employing from the private sector myself, because I took this pretty seriously with the chair, and he certainly has excellent credentials and very strong evidence of success in the areas that we need. I interviewed John Brown, the chair of NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, as part of the appointment process. I have confidence, real confidence in him, and I understand the account that he gave of his own personal expertise, and that's why I selected him. So, I mean, we have put around this the strongest team that we have, and it's not that I wish I had a stronger one. I don't want to leave that impression with the committee. We have put a very strong team around this. The chair has been incredibly assiduous, and I do want to pay tribute to her in the way that she has assembled around her a team of people who can support this implementation. She has worked extremely hard to get the right people in place. So I'm as confident as I can be that this will work. We have put the resource in that it needs.
Okay. Mary Scanlon, finally.
Just a brief question to each of you. Ms Davidson, Paul Gray has, I feel, answered questions very straightforwardly with a degree of common decency, and I do thank you for apologising for what went wrong. Given that you've been in your position for nearly 2 years, Ms Davidson, and you've had oversight of a £50 million overspend on NHS 24, oversight of the cap, overspend of over £70 million. Would you like to take this opportunity to apologise, you know, for not learning lessons from the past and looking forward that, you know, things will be better? I won't be here, but our successor committee may look forward to not having to address on three separate occasions critical overspends in ICT. So can I ask if you'd like to take this opportunity, like your colleague, to apologise for the failings here?
So as Mr Gray was explaining earlier, I don't have personal responsibility or accountability either for the NHS 24 or for the CAP Futures programme. But what I absolutely do have personal responsibility for is ensuring that lessons are learned from all IT and digital projects and programmes across the whole of government, not just the central government sector. And I can absolutely give assurances that we do and continue to learn from them, that we are improving all the time the relationships and engagement between people who are responsible for delivering programmes and projects in different places. And we'll be particularly looking to learn the lessons from the experience of NHS 24 and of ARC Futures.
Right,
and
so
others.
You're failing to apologise. If I can just move on to Mr Gray. Mr Gray, this has been 7 years in the making. This project, NHS 24, started in January 2009. Can I apologise for giving you a wrong figure earlier? When you previously came to our committee in 2012, it was because the Registers of Scotland, their estimated ICT project was estimated cost £66 million. The final cost was £112 million. So at that time, it was a significant overspend, double the price. And there are also continuing concerns about ROS, Registers of Scotland. Given that you've been very honest today, and given that it's Audit Scotland that has brought these millions and millions of overspend to our attention, would you, as accountable officer, not be looking to cabinet secretaries and ministers to take some responsibility in these difficult financial times for our councils and our health service? Is it not reasonable to expect our ministers to take some responsibility too? I've heard no apology or no acceptance of responsibility for the huge overspends here. Is that a reasonable request from an about-to-retire MSP? In a democratic government. Well, we can live in hope.
Well, let me say three things, Ms Scanlon. Firstly, I think, in fairness to Ms Davidson, she shouldn't be asked to apologise for things for which she's not the accountable officer. I'm the accountable officer for this. Ms Davidson had no responsibility for the overspend in NHS 24. I did, and I've accepted it, and I've apologised. Secondly, as to ministers, ministers are rather dependent on their civil servants. Any colleagues here who have been ministers will know that. I'm the accountable officer. I'm responsible. I'm apologising. And thirdly, what is reasonable to ask of ministers? I think a lot's asked of ministers, and again, I don't mean ministers of this particular government, that isn't reasonable, but I have never found ministers of any government slow to apologise for things that they got wrong themselves. But I don't think ministers got this wrong. I think we did.
They still have to accept responsibility.
Can I just ask finally, in terms of you've recognised some of the humility that you've shown, but if this was any other business that you were running that was running at a loss of over £50 million, and we've referred to some of the differentiations and the differentiating some of the figures that's been referred to, when can we hope that these losses will come to an end? I mean, what's the five-year plan, the 10-year plan to ensure that these losses won't continue? Because no business out there could continue with these losses, and the government shouldn't think of it in any other way.
No, it's a fair point, Convener. I think.
Can you give me a five-year plan? When can we expect to see a return that says that NHS 24 will not be running at a loss?
So NHS 24 has a plan to return its brokerage, and when that brokerage is complete, NHS 24 should not be running at a loss.
Yeah, but to be fair, that's not the answer to the question.
Sorry.
Surely when you've provided the brokerage to NHS 24, you can't continue to write blank cheques. That's unacceptable. No organisation can continue to do that. If it was a business, they'd be bankrupt and somebody else would be taking over. So you've given them a blank cheque because you've said, here's the leverage. But surely the conditions attached to that are that the organisation stops running at a loss to public purse, because there's facilities across the whole of Scotland being closed down because of the savings that this, or the overruns and budget that this organisation's taking.
I'm sorry if I'm...
Let's forget about humility. You've apologised. Yeah. You know, we've heard all the apologies, but now's the time to deliver. So when are you going to deliver to ensure that NHS 24 doesn't keep receiving blank cheques? Because nobody else does. NHS Glasgow have been advised to make £69 million worth of savings, along with others. They don't get the blank cheque, so why should NHS 24?
Well, NHS 24 does have to repay what it got, so it doesn't simply get...
I understand that, but tell me when.
So, NHS 24 should implement this system in the summer, and from that point on, it ought to be financially sustainable. It ought not to require further brokerage. So from this summer, I expect NHS 24 to be financially sustainable. Can I predict what might happen in 2 years' time? I can't, Convener, and I won't try to, but from the summer, I expect NHS 24 to be financially sustainable.
But let's put on the record today, when do you expect, because you are the accountable officer, yeah, your person's came here today, you've had to apologise, which we accept, but let's forget about that, and you confirm to me, and what would any other business would be expected to do the exact same? And organisations across the NHS sector have been asked to make cuts and ensure that they cut their cloth accordingly and that they don't find themselves in a budget overrun. So when, and all of them have been required to do this because NHS Glasgow have been advised that there's to be a 10-year plan, a five-year financial plan to confirm that they have to make £69 million worth of savings. So what's the financial plan for NHS 24 to ensure that they run according to the budget?
So NHS 24 is required to submit its draft financial plans in March of this year and to have them finalised by May, and that is the point at which we will have clarity about that. But I'm and seeking to answer your question, Convener, what I'm saying is I do not expect us to have to provide...
No, but that's not the question I'm asking you. Will they have a break-even budget? When can they expect to be running that?
So they should have a break-even budget by May of this year.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, sorry if I misunderstood you.
Yeah, so there'll be a break-even budget by which that point the government won't be providing any more leverage to allow them to exist.
That's no additional brokerage. That's the answer,
okay,
I'm giving.
So that's
you.
The position, yeah, that we're expecting this financial year.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Can I thank both witnesses for time? Can we move into a brief 5-minute suspension? Thank you. Thank you, colleagues. We now move to agenda item number 3, which is evidence on the AGS report entitled the 2014-15 Audit of Coatbridge College Governance of Severance Arrangements. Welcome our panel of witnesses this morning. Professor Alice Brown, the Chair of the Scottish Funding Council, Lawrence Howells, the Chief Executive, John Kemp, the Director of Access Skills and Outcome Agreements at Scottish Funding Council. I understand that Professor Brown has a short opening statement to make.
Yes, indeed, Convener. Thank you very much. Can I thank you for inviting us to this committee again, and we very much welcome the opportunity to discuss this very important matter and to provide a brief opening statement. Can I first emphasise, as we did in our written submission, how seriously we take what happened at Coatbridge. We're grateful for the Auditor General's report and your subsequent hearings, which have shone a very bright and necessary spotlight on this issue. At the time, colleges were not public bodies, but since April 2014, they now are, and therefore the Scottish Public Finance Manual applies. The SPFM considerably strengthens the rules on severance, as you will be aware. Colleges must now obtain the SFC's, the Funding Council's, prior approval before any severance payments can be made. Indeed, it's a condition of grant now. And as stated in our written submission, the Funding Council is taking a number of steps to learn crucial lessons from what happened. We do understand the need to be more proactive in ensuring good governance across the college sector, and that is something we're already doing. And while today is not the time to go into specifics, just one example of this is the Funding Council's approach to the issues that arose at Glasgow Clyde College Board last year. We will also be implementing the recommendations of the College Good Governance Task Group without delay. The group, of which Lawrence Howells, our Chief Executive, is a member, will be reporting next month. Can I also take this opportunity to update the committee on just two matters? First, our revised severance guidance, which we delayed finalising until your report on Coatbridge was completed, has now been issued. Also, together with New College Lanarkshire, we had asked Mr. Doyle to respond to our letter seeking return of a proportion of the severance payment he received in time to be able to share his response with this committee. We understand from our legal advisers that he has not yet given a substantive response, but has indicated he will do so soon. We will consider next steps with the college when we get his response. Thank you again for this opportunity. We're happy to answer your questions this morning.
Okay. Firstly, Professor Brown, can I ask, on behalf of the Funding Council, do you accept all the contents of our report on the Coatbridge College?
We do accept the contents of your report.
And the recommendations.
And the recommendations. We raised in our written submission, we thought one aspect wasn't fully justified, and that was with respect to the support for the colleges going through what was a major regionalisation process.
So is that not the fact then you don't support, you don't accept the recommendations if you feel that part of it is not justified? I mean, that's different from...
We accept the recommendations. We were just putting additional information into the public domain that, in fact, we did do a lot to support colleges going through this process. As you will recall, there were 10 mergers taking place within a period of 18 months. And for anyone who's been involved in the merger process, as I'm sure some of you have, it's a very complex thing to undertake. Particularly complex when you've got to ensure that students are continue to be taught well through that process. Hugely disruptive for students, hugely disruptive for staff.
But you now, will accept the disruption to students is that Mr. Doyle received £304,000, well above the recommended amount, and as a result of poor governance in that organisation, that affected students. So the role of the Scottish Funding Council in assisting the process, we have advised that we think that could be more proactive. Is that not? I mean, we've said that lessons have to be learned from this. So why do you feel not just unjustified in our recommendation?
I'm not saying you're unjustified
That's
in your recommendation.
That's what it says here. It says that we don't feel that this recommendation is justified.
Fully justified, because of the additional information I've given you. But we fully accept we could have been very more proactive, particularly in relation to issuing the severance guidance more timely, just at the point of merger. You'll recall that we did issue merger guidance, but the severance guidance was not reissued. One of the ironies, of course, is this particular college, Coatbridge College, it was reissued to them in January 2013. They chose not to take that advice and follow that guidance, and that's a different matter.
Yeah. Okay, can I now come back to the issue relating to the correspondence that we exchanged in connection with the information relating to business cases? And what you advised us was that you'd asked us to amend the official report to reflect the fact that Mr. Kemp felt that the information was provided adequately. Can I ask for the one business case that was provided for all of the for all the colleges referred to here? Was that the full business case that we were provided with?
That's a rather separate point from the point we were making. You're referring to the letter that I sent about information provided to the committee.
Yes.
When I heard the comments made when you published your report that the Scottish Funding Council hadn't produced information that this committee had asked for, I was rather alarmed that that would be the case. So I obviously asked members of the executive why information had not been provided. I was then given the full information about what had been provided and when it was asked for and what had been delivered. So I think that was a point I was trying to make, that I would be alarmed if you didn't receive information that you'd requested, and therefore I wanted to know what the circumstances were around those points. And I think I was satisfied that, in fact, information that had been asked for at particular times was provided. There was some confusion around particular issues, a question that was asked in a letter for information rather than what was actually said at a committee hearing. And I think Lawrence Hamilton apologised for any confusion around that. But in no way did we attempt to provide.
Can I just clarify,
though,
the information we asked for was all the business cases that could be provided in connection with the severance payments to college principals. Mm-hmm. Now, according to this table, there was only one business case provided. I'll come back to that in a second. So there's an attachment to this document that provides, and I think that's in relation to Langside College. But when I interrogate the document further, it doesn't look like I have a full copy of the business case. It looks like I've got an extract of a particular annex in the document. So we asked for a full copy of the business case, and we've not received a full copy of the business case. So can you understand our frustration?
Mm-hmm. I certainly do, if that's the case, and I'll ask Dr. Kemp to answer that point.
Yeah, the reason you have one business case, and
it's not one business case, it's an extract of one business case. Well, the point I'm making here is, I've a two-page document here. Mm-hmm. It refers to various annexes in the document. It refers to Annex F and other annexes. So it looks like I've got two pages of a much larger business case document. So I think it's a very fair question for the committee to ask the question about this incomplete.
That's the first time we've heard that,
Well, you've provided the document, and it's not the full document.
No, but it's the first time we've heard that's your concern. We're happy to follow that up and see whether there are other annexes
I'll come on to the actual issues related to the business case in a second. But you do accept that the document that we have for Langside College, we asked for the business case and were provided with an extract, is that correct?
We don't
have the full document here.
I'm not aware whether this is the full business case or whether the annexes refer to something else, but we can follow that matter up.
Okay. On the issue of business cases, and just again for clarity, when Mr. Howells, when you met with the committee in your evidence session, I asked you the question, Mr. Doyle may come before us and advise us that other principals received similar deals. And what you advise me of is that for it to be approved over and above the severance payments that have been referred to, a business case should be provided. That's what you said. Is that correct?
Our guidance required business cases for exceptional payments with the schemes that were generally operating in the other colleges. So what you have is the case where there was apart from Mr. Doyle's case, where there was an exceptional case. All the other cases of the principals, the schemes were in line with the general schemes for all staff.
So when we say they were in line with the general schemes, would that also be that you would expect those schemes to meet with the guidance circular that was issued in the year 2000, is that correct?
Yes.
So let's look at the table that you provided us with. Because when you look at the table, significant sums are referred to in the columns where it's referred to payment in lieu of notice. Now, your guidance refers to the fact that payment in lieu of notice should be avoided, except in very exceptional circumstances. Now, that means then that I would expect this column to maybe have one or two principals who find themselves in that exceptional position. So why then have we got all of these principals receiving significant sums of public money, and it appears that apart from the ones that have been referred to Audit Scotland, the Langside College one is the only one that has a business case? Do we not do, I mean, does, when people receive sums out with the guidance scheme that's been set out by the Scottish Funding Council, should it not be accepted then that the college should say, yeah, well, if we're going to pay this lump, this significant lump sum, and there's others here, there's pension payments of over £200,000 in one of them, would that have required a business case?
The system in operating at that time was that the business cases were made to the board, and our guidance was that they should be made and retained, and that was then looked at by auditors later on. We were not part, the business case did not have to be sent to us at that stage.
Do you think you were paying the checks? So Mr Howells, you were the accountable officer, so you're responsible for public funds being paid to these principals under guidance, which is more specific than probably people would give you credit for. Because when you look at the guidance that was set in the year 2000, it's quite specific about what's required. So when you look at that, did you not say to your officials, including Mr Kemp, maybe we should ensure that these funds that are going out the door, that there's a business case attached to them to make sure that these are Provinces' best use of public money? Or did you just let them go out the door?
At the time, it was the decisions on these arrangements were a matter for the individual boards. Of course, and you
provide the funds to those boards. So indeed, it was your funds that was allowing those payments to be paid, was
indeed.
It not?
I understand that. And that's why...
You were the accountable officer.
Indeed. And that's why we've now... in a preferable situation where since April 2014 these arrangements now have to be approved by SFC. But at the time they were the responsibility of the boards, and as we know, we didn't run colleges and we don't run colleges, and we were relying on that delegated authority to those boards to take forward these arrangements within the context of our guidance. I agree with you that it's regrettable that that didn't happen, and I think that's why we're now in a position where, with tightening up of the arrangements and tightening up the rules, we're now in a better situation. And I can only apologise on behalf of the boards involved in the sector concerned that this happened. And I think where we are now is in a much different situation. And the new situation,
The word, the reference to apologies this morning, the official report, we'll keep the official reporters busy. We've heard the apologies before, and whilst they're welcomed, I suppose what the issue here is getting down to the bottom of this. Here's a table that provides payments that were made over and above the recognised scheme, and someone's received £200,000 as part of the pension scheme. Did nobody ever refer that to you, Mr Hills, and say to you, look, this payment is one of the payments that we've heard about at the college. Did that not alarm you? Was there ever anything brought to the Funding Council that said...
The cases that were brought were the ones where the auditors in the college and the Auditor General identified significant concerns in governance, and those are covered in the Auditor General's report of 2015, and that highlighted the two cases that we know of, North Glasgow and Coatbridge.
So let me just... Finally, then, let's look at this. It's £50 million worth of public funds that are going into the merger process. Mm-hmm. Okay? So it would have been no secret to anyone that as part of that mergers process, there would have to be significant sums of money put in place to deal with principals who could no longer continue to be part of the colleges where there was a merger taking place. So you would have known that the college, the Scottish Funding Council is paying this money to these colleges to pay off these principals. Did you never say, I'd need to make sure that whatever funds has been paid to these individuals is appropriate? So did you see the funds, for example, the one that I've referred to, £200,000 for pension payments being paid to one of the colleges, and a number of other payments that were made. Have you never had any sight of these?
we didn't have sight of those before they were made. In the case of Coatbridge, we were aware of what was happening, and that's why we intervened in that particular case.
So in the college, in Coatbridge, you only intervened after the Auditor General, you were made aware of the
Auditor General? In the case of Coatbridge, we were made aware before it had been happened and we were active. The Auditor General's report came afterwards.
Okay. So can I ask you this question just finally? It's one I've always wanted to ask you. Mm. Did it never occur to you when we became made aware of the fact that Mr. Doyle was seeking these payments well and over above what was being recommended? Did it never occur to you that the Scottish Funding Council should say, we are not paying the money?
Yeah, exactly.
We took that judgment at that time that we would limit any payment we made to the standard payment, 13 months. I accept the judgment of the committee that when I went to the board, I could have been stronger. I should have said...
No, I'm not asking you about when you went to the board. Mr. Hill, you've got the checkbook. The only way that Mr. Doyle can get paid the money is if you say to him, yes, this money will get paid to you. If it was made clear to him that he wasn't going to receive the money in the first place and you weren't going to sign the cheque, you would have stopped that process being taken any further because you would have advised him that the Scottish Funding Council was not going to make the payment. Is that not fair?
So at the time, it was the responsibility of the boards to make those payments.
Make the decision, yes, but not for you. It was not your responsibility to give Mr. Doyle the money. Was it, or to give the board the money? It wasn't your responsibility.
We did not write the cheque to Mr.
Eventually.
Doyle. And in fact, we contacted the college and asked them not to make the payment.
We know that.
They went ahead and made the payment. I appreciate your question is about what we should have done after that.
But you advise Mr. Doyle? Was Mr. Doyle advised that the payment wouldn't be made?
The payment wasn't going to come from us. We could have chosen not to make a payment for the proportion that
exactly.
we did pay to the college.
That's the point.
But that issue would have been relevant after Mr. Doyle had the cheque paid by the college, us asking the college not to do that.
I suppose I'll just finish on this question and maybe this is a bit clearer. Yeah. Did the Scottish Funding Council contact Mr. Doyle or the college, the chairperson of the college, Mr. Gray, and advise him, you can agree to whatever payment you want, Mr. Gray, but we are not paying this money. You asked them not to do it. There's a difference between asking them not to do it and saying we're not going to provide you with the funding. So did you?
To be accurate, what we did was we said we will not pay above the 13 months. We didn't say we won't pay you anything in relation to Mr. Doyle. That's
right.
A fact.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, so you said we're not going to pay above 13 months.
Yes.
But you did?
No.
So the college did?
Yes.
So you provided the funds to allow for the for the 13 months up to. So that's the sum that's referred to in the call in the payments here. So you said we will pay the 13 months. So if you said I'm not paying the 13 months because you've agreed to well above the scheme that we've agreed, would that not be more appropriate?
Well, we took the judgment at the time that the danger there was that that takes another 100,000, whatever the number is, out of the services the new college could give to students.
But it's happening anyway, because if you're paying the money, then that's money that can go to the college sector anyway.
Indeed, but if we'd taken a further 100,000 back out of the system. So that was the judgment we took at the time. We accept that the committee has advised you believe we should have taken a different judgment.
Yeah.
And we're now in a different situation where actually when these cases won't happen
Mr. Doyle was arranging for this and he was looking at, I'm going to get this package together, and he was colluding with others to do that. If he was made aware that you weren't even going to give him the 13 months, then he couldn't take it any further. That's the way position he would have been in. If you'd advised him, we won't even pay the 13 months, then he wouldn't have been able to do that. And he would have maybe tried to take it out of the college funds, but that would have been much more of an issue for him, would it not?
Indeed. He would have taken it. The college. It was for the college to pay it. The college could have paid it out of their general funds. What I couldn't have done is stop paying the college any money, if you like, because, you know, the money for running the college is necessary for running the college. So I would be paying the college money every month. Of course I would. It's their responsibility to decide what they pay on in any particular month. It clearly would have sent a more forceful message to the college to say, well, instead of offering to pay 13 months for Mr. Doyle, I'll pay you nothing. And I accept that we should have been more forceful at that moment. But the college could still have gone ahead and paid that £300,000 out of funds that it had.
Mary Scanlon.
Yes, can I just talk about being forceful? I'm referring to you, the letter you've sent to convener of 17th February, where, if I put it in my own words, you seem to grudgingly accept the recommendations of this committee. Can I just ask a few brief questions? Now, I don't want to pick over the coals because obviously we spent huge amounts of time on this, but I do think in terms of future governance that we really need to ensure ourselves in our own minds that this is not likely to happen again. In terms of being forceful, Mr. Howells, at the critical meeting of the board of Coatbridge College that you attended to tell them you're not paying £304,000 to John Doyle. You will stay within the recommended guidelines of the Scottish Funding Council, and we would expect no less of you to do that. Why did you leave after 10 minutes? Was that your choice, or was it their choice?
To be honest, let me tell you my experience of that meeting, which was we entered the meeting and... I wouldn't say there was an entirely a welcoming atmosphere. I had ready what I wanted to say to the board, and as you can see from the minutes of that meeting, I effectively made sure that that board heard from me orally the essence of our guidance. I made it clear to the board that I had would be interested in debating with them and would be, you know, keen to have a dialogue with the board. I reached a point where there was no dialogue happening. There was one or two questions, and at that point we were invited to leave. I could have stayed and repeated the points I'd made, and on reflection, you know, maybe I should have been more forceful. And that's one of the things that we learnt in subsequent events from this event. However, my main purpose was to be absolutely make sure that every member of that board was absolutely clear of what I understood our guidance to be, and that they, you know, that they would take that on board. Our experience, we have learned from this, and it is clear that you know, there are occasions where we need to be more forceful in these occasions, and some of the events that Professor Brown referred to subsequently show where we've been trying to do that harder.
Okay, well, it really doesn't matter whether you were welcome or not, or whether they weren't talking Indeed. To you. You had a very serious job to do on behalf of the Scottish taxpayer,
Indeed.
And indeed on behalf of the Scottish Government. Indeed. And probably you'd have saved this committee an awful lot of time, an awful lot of reading, a huge amount of work, and I give credit to every member of this committee. I think we've done a thorough job here, and I retire in 3 weeks. I would have to say to you, Mr. Howells, I was very disappointed, and I'm talking personally, not on behalf of the committee, I was very disappointed at the role of the Scottish Funding Council, because I really just think that John Doyle and John Gray ran circles around you. And that is very disappointing, and I stand by every single comment and recommendation in our report and appreciate that you say it was not fully justified. Can I just come to my second question? Did the government put so much pressure on you to make sure that the mergers happened that you were willing to turn a blind eye to John Doyle and John Gray? And just secondly there, the Auditor General mentioned collusion. Now, collusion by John Gray and John Doyle, following the fact that, I appreciate it was Mark Batho at the time, the fact that the guidelines were set out to them, collusion in order to get the Remuneration Committee to pay an extra $200,000 almost to John Doyle is a very serious matter indeed. In fact, in my dictionary, it's fraud. Now, this will be overlooked. I imagine today's official report will also go to the police. Do you agree with this committee? And do you also agree with the Auditor General that John Gray and John Doyle colluded in order to ensure that the Remuneration Committee were not fully informed of the SFC guidance and to ensure that John Doyle got significantly additional amounts of taxpayers' money that he was not entitled to? Do you agree with that?
Yes.
Thank you. My next point is, I'm interested in preventing the senior team receiving an unjustifiable package, but I don't want to digress. But my, if you want to answer that quickly, I'm happy about that. But the point that really concerns me is you had sanctions and you didn't use them. And probably because the college knew perfectly well you weren't going to use them, that allowed them to help themselves and line their own pockets. Because you've said that, wait a minute, paragraph, you referred to paragraph 299 in our report, and you have sanctions not to pay them the money. You decided that you wouldn't bother penalising John Doyle because this would result in penalising students and staff. Now, if you had sanctions that you weren't willing to use at any point in any time, did you ever go to the Scottish Government and say, this isn't really working, you're giving us sanctions that are worthless, you know, we need greater sanctions in order to ensure taxpayers' money is not wasted, because you did not use the sanctions that were available to you. Can you answer that?
Indeed, and I accept that position. I guess that's why we're the new arrangements post 2014 give us a new power in respect of these particular events.
I'm talking about, you know, we'll have to go over this.
I accept that.
We're referring to our report.
In relation to your report, we didn't. You're correct. We did not recover that or pay nothing for John Doyle's severance. We've been there before for the reasons we've given. And during that process, no, we didn't say to the government right then, no, we need extra sanctions. However, post the event from April 2014, we now have the authority to decide.
Well, you were given sanctions that you refused to use, which made life easy for John Doyle and John Gray. Have you ever used those sanctions?
Yes, we used the sanction of withholding grant quite frequently. The reason we didn't use it...
In terms of severance payments. Right, you've never used it.
No, I mean,
in terms of severance.
I can't think of an occasion where we've used it.
Do you realise the signal that puts out?
No.
John Gray and John Doyle knew perfectly well they could do what they want.
Yeah. If I can explain why we didn't use it, and we did consider this, the reason we didn't use it in the context of the John Doyle and John Gray issue was, as you in your earlier question said, you know, this was an issue of apparent collusion between two people to achieve.
It wasn't apparent, according to Lawrence Howells. He said it was collusion.
Yeah, no, I'm not disagreeing with that at all. Okay. But those two people had exited the college pretty much on the evening that Mr. Howells had attended the board meeting. And our view was, and despite us asking that they not make any payment until we could, you know, completely get to the bottom of what their decision was, they made the payment, and Mr. Doyle had the money in his bank account almost immediately after the board meeting. Our view was at that stage, once the money had left the college, that were we to use the sanction of not paying the grant or withholding grant for the whole amount, it would only have impacted on the college. We did, as you know from your earlier discussions at this committee, consider options about, we sought legal advice on whether we could recover it from board members who had taken a decision which was against our guidance, and the advice was that that was unlikely to succeed. So we did consider other options, but the option of not, or either withholding grant or not applying part of the grant for the merger, was one we didn't think would work, because the money had already been paid to Mr. Doyle, and we didn't think there was a prospect that were we to withhold it from the college, he would immediately repay it.
So, do you understand why, personally, I can only speak for myself, yeah. Do you understand why I'm very disappointed at the role of the Scottish Funding Council in its lack of supervision, oversight and scrutiny, and indeed management of the Coatbridge severance payments? Do you understand my personal disappointment?
I can understand the anger of people at this event and our role in it. In our defence, as we've said in the letter, we did know about this issue in advance, and we tried using all the powers we had at our time then to prevent it. And no. But I can understand your anger.
A 10-minute meeting where you were unwelcome and nobody was talking to you. I mean, that's hardly using all the powers at your disposal. I mean, you are a serious government agency here with a serious budget, and you allow yourself to be pummeled around by John Doyle and John Gray, who make you unwelcome, and nobody's talking to you, so you leave after 10 minutes. I'd have stayed there for 10 hours until they got the message, but you just walk out the door quietly and meekly. That's not using all the powers at your disposal.
I've accepted before that we should have been more forceful, and we've learnt from that, and we're doing that in the future.
Thank you, Convener. Professor Brown, would you agree that the Scottish Government put considerable faith in the SFC and its central role in the merger of the colleges?
Yes, it did. And the SFC worked in partnership also with Scottish Government officials and the change team in taking forward the merger process.
In retrospect, do you believe that you fully met that faith?
I think the Scottish Funding Council, you must remember that I wasn't chair at the time, so I'm reflecting on what happened, and I've been looking at all the paperwork as well. I think the Scottish Funding Council achieved a lot in the 18 months of merger, when there was 10 mergers to undertake. I think in hindsight, and clearly with the evidence that's been produced through the Auditor General and your own inquiries, there's things the Funding Council could have done better, and I think the Funding Council totally accepts that. The matter was brought to the attention of our board again in January of this year, when all members of the board get a copy, of course, of your report, and indeed had a report from the Chief Executive. And we'll be looking very, very carefully at all the steps that will be taken to make sure this kind of thing doesn't happen again as far as we can. But one of the things here is to think about it in the context of a whole governance framework. That there's different roles and responsibilities and lines of accountability at play here. And you start with, clearly, the appointment of principals and their terms and conditions, the appointment of chairs of boards and their terms and conditions and so on, and the appointment of board members. And the point that you also make in your report about the adequate training of those, and that's a point that we definitely will be taking up and we are taking up at present. But within that, you've got the checks and balances of auditors, both internal and external. You've got ourselves. You've got Oscar, who, again, you know, we're in discussions with Oscar. You've also got the Commission, the Standards Commission, and the Ethical Standards Commission. This kind of network and framework of governance that's part of looking at the whole picture. Now, I would say that framework failed on this occasion and failed the public. And certainly when you look at the kind of sums involved, I think you yourselves have described them as eye-watering, and I certainly find them so.
Professor Brown, yes? I'm finding what you say there sort of spreading the blame over everybody. I mean,
no, not at all. Not at all. We accept responsibility for our part in that. What I'm saying that in looking forward and learning lessons from this, we have to think about how that network works effectively to make sure that it doesn't happen again. It's not one institution, but we fully accept responsibility for our failure in this respect.
And perhaps I can ask you one or two questions. I'd like to pick up on something the convener actually was asking about business cases, because the answer to the convener, and I think it might have been Mr. Kemp actually that answered that one, was that business cases did not require to come to yourself. They just had to exist and be presented, I think, to the board or the colleges. I think that was the term that was used. However, in page 3 of your letter of 17th February, the third paragraph down that starts with paragraph 299 of the report, it says here that the guidance did not require the college to share the business case for any exceptional payments. Now, you're specifying exceptional payments. Does that sort of implies that in the normal course the business case would come forward, but in exceptional cases, which presumably is where the college is picking up that part of the cost, it doesn't come forward?
We maybe could have written that sentence better. What it means is that where there was no exceptional payment, no business case, no individual business case would be needed for a payment. If the principal was simply getting exactly the same deal as everyone else, it was non-exceptional and no business case was needed. Where it was exceptional and a business case was needed, that still didn't need to be shared with the SFC.
So you're saying you don't need a business case if it's just a... within the terms of the...
Yeah, the college, our guidance was that if the the principal, for example, was getting exactly the same deal in terms of months for, you know, years of service as everyone else. No individual business case was needed. It was just part of the wider scheme.
But wouldn't you still need a business case to say that that it was justified and that it was appropriate and that, you know, the payback period for this was appropriate? Wouldn't you still have to have a business case for that?
It would be implied that the scheme itself covered those issues because it would cover the length of service that qualified for a particular payment, and therefore the payback would be included in that. And in the context of a merger, I can see your point. If it hadn't been in a merger, if you're making a severance deal with the principal, you need to consider, well, we need another principal. But this is in the context of a merger, where there'd be fewer principals. I'd just like to make the point, though, that, of the lessons we've learned from this, had the Scottish Public Finance Manual not changed this so radically, we heard earlier, it'd mean that essentially our previous guidance is irrelevant. But had that not happened, I think this is one of the lessons that we would have been very carefully learning, because these things were happening through a system that wasn't within our sight at the time, and that's a lesson that we would have had to learn had it not been dealt with otherwise by the SPFM.
During the course of this whole process, did you see yourselves in a supervisory role, any sort of a watchdog role in relation to this and the payment of monies?
We had a variety of roles in that we were encouraging the merger programme, we were supporting the merger programme, but we were also aware we had a supervisory role as well. That's why we intervened to the extent we did in Coatbridge. There were other cases as well where we did have to express views on ways that things were going, and many of those have not come to light because they were resolved, but we did see we had a supervisory role as well as the supporting role and other roles we had in the merger progress.
Again, looking at the third page of the letter of 17th February, I'm looking at the statement here, we were successful in preventing the senior team from receiving an unjustifiable package.
Yeah.
If you were successful with the senior team, it still seems strange to me that you were not successful with the principal. So what was the difference in approach there?
Our approach was exactly the same in both cases, and many of the actions that you've had described in earlier meetings about our interaction with Coatbridge were about both cases, because they were both live issues right up until the end, where they dropped the additional payment to the senior managers but retained the payment to John Doyle. So our approach was very similar. We saw all of them as unacceptable. We took the actions that you've heard about in earlier meetings. We had the chair and principal in to express our concerns, and by the time Mr. Howells attended the board meeting, I think we knew that the senior management team one had been dropped, so it was down to Mr. Doyle. But essentially the process was the same.
So given the same process, why do you think it was successful in preventing the senior team from receiving an unjustifiable package, but not Mr. Doyle? Yeah.
I was going to say you'd have to ask Mr. Gray and Mr. Doyle that, but you have, and you've reached your conclusion, and it's one we agree with.
Okay. Now, coming back to the meeting that Mr. Howells attended, Mr. Howells made the statement that he was invited to leave. Now, my understanding is he was there for 10 minutes. And at the end of 10 minutes, when you'd stated, probably in 10 minutes, not all that much, given you were talking about there was questions and so forth, you were then invited to leave. How did that happen? What did you think as you were asked to leave?
There weren't many questions, to be quite honest. I'll be really honest. What did I think? I thought, I've got my message across. There's nobody in this board that can possibly not have understood what I'm expecting of them. I'm now expecting them to go into a debate amongst themselves and challenge the chair and the Remuneration Committee about the way forward. That's honestly what I thought. I think it's been suggested maybe that was naive of me to think that. I'd got my points across. I was expecting that board now to say, actually, we now need to follow this guidance.
Did you during the course of that 10 minutes indicate that this funding council would be still prepared to pay the 13-month severance?
The minutes say that if the decision... let me see. The minutes don't record that I said...
They don't record very much at all.
No. I said you need to follow your guidance. If you're going to go beyond the 13 months for everybody else, you're going to need to have go through these processes.
But did you indicate that you were prepared to fund that portion of it?
I don't think we talked about our funding at that meeting.
You said that you could not have changed the mind of the board. Again, the same letter, page 3. That you would not have changed the minds of the board. So you left that... Presumably, you left that meeting after 10 minutes believing that you couldn't change the mind of the board and that the board
I'll be really honest. I left that meeting thinking the board's heard what they have to do. I now expect them to do it. That's honestly what I thought at the time.
But then the letter says about not being able to change the minds of the board. I mean, that doesn't seem logical. If you left believing that they'd heard the message, you presumably believed that they would take note of it and do something about it.
At the time.
But then you say here... on what basis did you believe that you couldn't change the mind of the board? At what point?
I think in our letter we're referring to the whole situation and the aftermath of it. But I'm honestly saying what I thought when I walked out of that meeting. And if our letter doesn't give that accurately, I apologise for that.
Yeah, I mean, I have to say that I find the role of the SFC in this quite weak.
Yeah. Here. I have two areas that I want to look at. One is that my understanding of how and why the senior management additional payments were not made on the same basis as John Doyle was because the letter they'd received expired on the 31st of July. This committee, I don't think, has ever seen the letter related to John Doyle. Have you seen that letter? Because if it said expiring on the 31st of July as well, then the board is... doubly culpable for failing to take cognizance of the guidance that was offered to them. Have you actually attempted to ascertain that at any point?
I think our view has been that if it was not in accordance with the guidance, it should have been set aside.
Yes, but my understanding of the basis for John Doyle receiving the package was they felt, on the advice of the lawyers, that they were contractually obliged because of previous correspondence to pay that. Whereas they clearly weren't in the case of the senior management because of the termination letter of the original proposals for merger, which had to be submitted to you on the 31st of July. So you didn't seek to clarify that subsequently and haven't ever sought to clarify that. I mean, I know it's bolting the stable door after the horse is well and truly bolted, and bolted pretty fast in this case, but actually...
I mean, it's an important question, the role of the board and what basis the board acted. We haven't clarified that particular point, to my knowledge. Again, I think it is back, as Dr. Kemp said. We thought if it wasn't in line with guidance, then it didn't stand anyway. But it is back to what was the role of that, the whole of that board in looking after the affairs of the college and their responsibility to challenge.
Well, I mean, these matters may be sub judice in due course, but what I'm really interested in, the other thing is that if we go back to Stevenson and Telford College, that's in 2011-12, the severance payments... under a regional scheme were 21 months. So there was in existence this Edinburgh scheme, which was at odds with the scheme that you were promoting as part of the merger process. And yet, again, in Angus in 2012-13, a whole year later, we have another 21 month under a general scheme. So we've got two areas in Scotland where we've got general schemes that John Doyle quoted in his proposals to have a regional scheme for Lanarkshire. So, you know, I have some understanding of where he was coming. Here's three principals got away with 21 months pay and some of them 52 and 23,000 pounds in lieu of notice in addition to that. So they'd got away with 249,000 and 202,000. Why shouldn't I have a good go at getting the same scheme? That seems only fair. Why should I be penalised and not have the same scheme others are getting? Did you comment on those schemes as they went through?
Our view was that 21 months was something we couldn't justify funding from our funding, and we didn't fund up to 21 months.
No, but did you comment that it was at odds with the guidance
at that stage,
I know you weren't responsible, the boards made the decisions, but as the funding council handling the public money, did you comment at all on the fact that this was basically well in excess, this was... 8 months at least in excess of the maximum amount that you were prepared to fund?
We did. Colleges were well aware that the maximum amount we would fund would be roughly a year payback, and that sometimes meant a 13-month scheme. The 21 months that was offered by some colleges, and I would stress, you know, with the excess above and the year payback, not with our money, was in line with voluntary severance schemes right across government. So we did not say to Edinburgh or to Dundee and Angus, we object to your scheme. What we said to them was, we are not prepared to fund all of your scheme. This is public money. We want to spread it around as much as possible. Now, the reason we objected in the case of Coatbridge to the proposed 21-month payment, or actually ended up being longer than that to John Doyle, but the proposed payment to the senior management team and John Doyle, as we understood it early in 2013, was that that was to be for only the senior management team and not for the whole of the college. Had they come to us and said, we have reserves, we want a 21-month scheme that will apply to everyone in all the merging colleges, including the principal, we would not have objected. Because let's be clear, the 21 months was a relatively standard scheme across the public sector in Scotland. We were prepared to fund a more meagre scheme, and most of the colleges went for that. But the issue with Coatbridge was the disjunction between the very generous scheme for the senior managers and the 13-month scheme for the other staff. That was what led to our initial objection. Now, some of how it was reported in the minute of the Remuneration Committee in January at Coatbridge, I think significantly misrepresented the Edinburgh scheme and said that was the standard across the sector. It wasn't alone, there were others, but it was quite unusual. And it implied that we would fund the whole thing. We wouldn't, and we didn't fund the 21 months at Edinburgh. We funded up to a 12-month payback. Yes, and as you'll see from the table we've given you, the SFC contribution in most of these cases is considerably less than the whole amount.
Yeah, well, no, we're not disputing the SFC's contribution at any point in this proceeding, but you've just said that the 21 months, and I think your words were, was a fairly general scheme across all government.
Yeah. I think the standard civil service scheme is 21 months.
So the scheme that was being proposed for severance as part of this really rapid and fairly forced merger process was to say, well, the civil servants can have 21 months, but the colleges can't have 21 months. So, I'm beginning to feel very confused about this, because if there's a general government view that 21 months was reasonable and that can apply to civil servants in the government, but cannot apply to college staff, I feel that to be really rather unfair.
Our view was that within the limited money we had available...
Oh, no, but that was the money that the government decided to give you. So the government give their own civil servants 21 months as a standard severance package. It's applied in Edinburgh as part of the regional scheme, because that's what your table says. It's applied in Angus because it's part of the regional scheme. But when it comes to Lanarkshire and Clydebank and the other area and the Glasgow areas, because they didn't have this scheme in place, they're not allowed to apply what is the general government scheme. What right have the government to turn around to say one class of employees that we're now going to take responsibility for are perfectly entitled to 21 months, but the rest of you, no, I'm sorry, we're only going to fund 13 months. What right has the government got to do that? Did you point out to the government that this was at odds with the general scheme that was available?
The colleges had the right, should they wish, to have a 21-month scheme for all of their staff. And what we objected to in Coatbridge was it was only for some staff. But any college could decide to have a 21-month scheme.
Without a business case, because presumably, the government scheme, you're telling us now, and correct me if I'm wrong, But the government scheme is that you do not just judge, it's not exceptional, there's nothing exceptional about it. You get up to 21 months if your employment's long enough. Bang.
Don't know the details of the government scheme at hand at the moment. We were quite clear that we were trying to achieve the mergers across the country with the resources we had. We wanted to, as John said, make that money available to support as many colleges as we possibly could to merge in a very short space of time. And that's why we offered 13 months. That's why we encouraged people.
Yes, I'm not blaming you for what you did in that respect, because you operated on the basis of the money the government gave you and the scheme that presumably the government told you to operate, which was the 13-month scheme.
The decision to limit funding to a one-year payback was the funding councils. It wasn't the government.
But it was based on the on your examination of the funds you were being... Did you ask the government then for 21 months? Did you ask for them to follow Telford and Stevenson and Angus and Ayr had all got 24, 21 months severance payments? Did you ask for that in 2013, that it should be enough money?
We didn't ask for 21 months across the system as a whole. However, the government did provide a one-off additional sum of money, I think it was 15 million, to support this merger programme, and that was what enabled us to afford our contribution of 13 months or one-year payback.
I mean, the actual redundancy scheme was 90 million, that we now know. The college redundancies as a whole cost 90 million. So actually, 34 million of that, am I correct? 34, yes, 34 million of that was met from college reserves that would otherwise be applied to teaching and students and the rest. So, you know, I think there's a lot of responsibility on the government here for not laying out an absolutely clear programme and then funding it that was fair in terms of what the civil service would have had. Thank you.
Yeah, can I just continue that line of argument in the sense that when the government announced the merger process and gave the funding council the resources that you were provided for to deliver the merger process, was there any discussion between either civil servants or ministers and the funding council about the political controversial nature of high severance payments?
I mean, we were clear what we would be offering in terms of schemes. I know. I don't recall a particular attention to that.
Do you mean severance payments in the context?
I mean, Mr. Kemp, I mean payments of £249,000 a year, £202,000, £126,058, £174,000, and £304,000. By any standards, pretty high payments.
No, I'm simply trying to clarify whether you meant 21 months as opposed to 4.
No, I'm interested in the sums involved here, which you provided to us in this table.
There was frequent discussion with the government on every aspect of the merger.
On severance payments.
On severance payments, certainly, when Coatbridge
because as Dr. Simpson has just been raising, there was before Coatbridge. Coatbridge, in some ways, is a red herring in this argument because these started in 2011-12, didn't they?
Yeah.
Did at any time ministers or senior civil servants say, hold on a minute, are we really going to start paying out 249, 202, 126, 174 in public money, taxpayers' money? Did that get raised at any stage?
In many cases, these payments are simply the standard scheme.
That's not
multiplied
by a
high
salary. That's not what I asked. I asked, was it raised? Was it discussed?
Not specifically.
No. Okay. So we've clarified that. So in that sense, there was no interest from senior civil servants or ministers about how much money was going to be used for specifically people leaving the colleges at principal level and senior management level at that time because of the merger process.
I think everybody accepted that if there was going to be change, then there would have to be departures of principals. And I think it was accepted that provided that was done within the rules, that was part of the necessary consequence of merging 25 colleges into 10.
But there was no specific discussion about the level of those payments and how that would then appear to an auditor, whether it was internally or to the Auditor General of Scotland or to a Public Accounts Committee or a Public Audit Committee of the Scottish Parliament.
I don't recall any specific discussions. However, the general principle of saying we have guidance, people need to follow the guidance, was part of the debate.
And the Auditor General had produced a report on exits.
Absolutely,
the,
yeah. No, indeed.
Which
indeed
was
so.
Available at that
worse.
Time.
Yes. It makes us a heck of a lot worse. Yeah. The, can I just also question this suggestion that the Funding Council only paid, we can take one example here, £102,308 out of a total package of £126,058, because the rest of that would have come from the college funding that that college received. So the idea that you, that I don't mean you personally, of course, Mr. Kemp, but the Funding Council only paid that amount when you were providing the college with all its funding, that's another red herring, isn't it?
And
because we got, as you all know from the Coatbridge evidence, they tried to make that case too. Darling, those two characters tried to say, oh, it came from commercial income, and then they couldn't justify it. So we know that's not the case either.
Indeed, and when I referred earlier to one of the lessons that we would have learned from this, had the SPFM not changed things considerably, that the system that was in place at the time meant that we did not know the outcome of these things until afterwards. And the system was auditors would pick them up, they would be reported to you as two cases were with Section 22s, or they wouldn't. Had things not changed, we would want to learn that lesson, and we would. And if Coatbridge had been number one in the list instead of last, we might have learned it.
Sure.
You know, at a different time. We accept that point.
Yeah, no, I think that's fair. Yeah. The only other one point I wanted to make was just on the business case. I mean, I just want to be clear for the record, as the convener was, that we did ask all the time. I think you can go back to the official report and look at all the times I asked about the business cases. So I wasn't taken with getting a letter saying that I needed to correct my position on it. I was very clear, as the convener was too, about the business cases all along. And actually, what you said this morning has rather confirmed that. So. We'll back off on that one.
Mr. Howells, you joined you became the Chief Exec of the Scottish Funding Council in April 2014, and you joined its predecessor organisation in 1994. And in that period of time, have you ever been asked to leave a meeting before?
Have I been asked to leave a board meeting or a meeting of that sort? I have been asked to leave meetings before. I don't think not in the context that you've described. And to be honest, we don't often. It's not a common event for us to go to board meetings. I think it's probably true to say that that board meeting was the first one that I went to in role of acting chief executive at the time. I have subsequently been to a board meeting at which I've been asked to leave. I learnt some of the lessons from the Coatbridge experience and was considerably more forceful in the debate. So in answer to your question, no, that's the first time in that role in that kind of situation.
Okay. What about, also, I accept it, I mean, it may well be and probably is unusual for the Chief Executive of the SFC to attend board meetings. But what about other staff members of the SFC? I mean, would they attend on a more regular basis?
For example, in the merger process, we attended virtually all the partnership board meetings of every merger, virtually every single case that occurred. So there's a lot of interaction in it during that period.
So in the, regarding these other meetings, was anyone else ever asked to leave any board meetings?
Subsequently, post Coatbridge, and from the lessons we've learned, I attended two meetings of boards, and certainly in one, I was also asked to leave along with Dr. Kemp and Chief Executive.
Okay, I know we are here to discuss Coatbridge, and the convener might stop me here, but are you able to tell the committee as to why you were asked to leave these subsequent meetings?
We were asked to leave because the chair said it was the decision of the board that they would hear what we had to say, but they didn't want to take any questions and discussions and would be asked to leave. I objected on a number of occasions, and I was then accused of not respecting the board. And we left under protest and asked for it to be minuted.
Okay. Well, now that that's on the record, I'm sure that certainly there'll be people with an interest in that particular situation. Are you able to tell us which institution that was?
It was Glasgow College's Regional Board.
Okay. And was that recently?
It was last year.
Last year, okay. Before the change. Okay. Was it before the change or after the change?
Before which change?
Was it before the new system that we have, or was it
It was in March, and it wasn't to do specifically with severance payments. It was more general governance issues.
Right, okay. Just to take it back to Coatbridge, just for a moment, because some of the areas that I was keen to question have been covered, but just on this issue regarding this meeting, when you were asked to leave Mr. Hills, did you raise any protests at that particular meeting? Did you stipulate or indicate that you felt that would be inappropriate at that particular time, or did you just leave?
From memory, I attempted to say, well, actually I'm here to have a discussion. You must have got questions. What are those questions? Can we talk about them? And got no response. I think there was one or two questions, but there was nothing. And again, attempting to pursue that dialogue, which seemed to be the right thing. But no, I've had no response, and I'd reached a point where I'd had my say, and it was now for that board to listen to that guidance and to do what was expected of them.
Okay, thank you.
Brief question from Mary Scanlon.
Yes, it's just a point of clarity. The £52 million that was allocated towards the merger process, was that specifically for voluntary for severance payments, or was it a more general sum? And can I just ask, Dr. Simpson mentioned that amount that was allocated to £52 million has increased considerably. Can you give, I think he said 90. I have another question too.
What I think Dr. Simpson was referring to, and correct me if I'm wrong, is if you add up our funding for the mergers with the other funding that came from college reserves and so on, it adds up to the higher figure. Is that correct, Dr. Simpson?
Right, so how does that differ from the £52 million that was mentioned in the Audit Scotland report?
I think the £52 million.
Are we over budget? That's what I'm asking.
No. It's the £52 million is a reference to the SFC funding.
Okay.
The figure that Dr. Simpson's referring to recognises the fact that colleges put in some of their own resources. For example, in Edinburgh, where we funded a voluntary severance scheme and paid up to a 1-year payback, the element between that and 21 months came from colleges reserves.
That's okay. So the SFC... I think it's important. Yeah. So the SFC aren't over budget on this one?
No.
Convener, can I just say, as part of the merger process, a promise was made for national pay bargaining. Now, I was an economics lecturer and further in higher education before coming in here, and I'm aware that my colleagues still in the University of the Highlands and Islands are paid up to £7,000 less than many people doing the same job in the same colleges in the Central Belt. For the same qualifications. Now, 3 years down the line from the promise of national pay bargaining, they are no further forward. And I note, convener, that strike action has been mentioned. Now, I'm obviously very much in favour of my colleagues, but it's going to be difficult to recruit in Highlands and Islands unless we pay them the same as elsewhere. When will we get national pay bargaining, and where will this money come from?
Firstly, on national pay bargaining isn't specifically related to the mergers. It wasn't part of the aim of the merger programme.
It was mentioned at the time.
No, it's part of the reforms of the college sector more widely, but it isn't specifically an aspect of the merger programme, though the merger programme arguably makes it easier.
It has been mentioned, convener, in Audit Scotland reports in the past, and that's the only reason I'm mentioning it today.
There has been quite a lot of progress on national pay bargaining. It is not quite there yet, and certainly the final aspect of it, pay harmonisation across the sector, is not imminent, because there are costs attached to that. The college sector has been working very closely with the unions on a framework for national pay bargaining, which is
almost in place. I think it's fair to say there are still some colleges that have to sign fully up to the national pay deal, and there's a series of concerns about how they operate as charities and how that can affect the kind of negotiating mechanism they have. So, but there has been considerable progress on that issue, and a recent letter of guidance from the government asked us to support the colleges in taking that forward further. And we have been in fairly active discussion with the colleges and indeed with EIS.
Well, pay harmonisation was promised by the Scottish Government prior to this merger process. You can understand that I have colleagues in the Highlands who are asking me, when is this happening? It's a significant amount of money. They have been promised that we want the same level of education and we want the same quality of lecturers in Highlands and Islands as elsewhere. When can I tell them that they'll get an extra 7,000 in their salary? Because it has been put on the cards 3 or 4 years now. I think I've been very patient here.
Yeah. I'm afraid I can't give an answer to that one. We are working very closely with the sector to try and move national pay bargaining forward.
Am I right in saying you're facing strikes because of this?
There are issues in the national pay bargaining arena at the moment, but the eventual point of when everyone is paid the same is some way off, and that's not what the issues are at the moment.
Okay. Can I just ask two very quick questions? Mr. Howells, you referred earlier to your attendance at the meeting with Coatbridge College. If I recall of the previous meeting, an official report will confirm that you advised us, that you advised the college, that if they were to fund the scheme from Mr. Doyle over and above the 13 months, then they would need to meet the costs. Is that correct?
Yes. So in that process, we were clear we were only ever going to fund up to 13 months.
Yeah. So, it wasn't going to be that concerning to Mr. Doyle. Really what you were saying was, we can provide the 13 months, folks, but anything else has got to come from the college. So it wouldn't have been the concern to Mr. Doyle that maybe you're trying to amplify today, that, Mr. Doyle would have been in no way concerned about that reference to you saying, we're only going to fund up to 13 months, because it's the way he would have seen it as match funding's in place. Not much funding, but the package is funding council this amount and the rest from the college. So I'm not really sure what the purpose of your attendance at the meeting was there.
My purpose was to make absolutely certain that board, whose responsibility that decision was, knew what they were expected to do. And
what were they expected to do?
If they were offering a deal that was outwith the deal for the rest of the thing, they had to justify it. That was what the rules. I was underlying the guidance at the time, and I was seeking to make sure that board knew what its responsibilities was.
But the board were never under the impression from you that they would have said, perhaps we shouldn't approve this scheme, just not approve it. Did you ever say that to them? Don't approve this scheme because it doesn't...
I didn't say that, because at that time it was their decision to make that that decision. And what there's a choice, what side of the line do we lie? If the system is that's their decision, the decision of boards, it's not my job to run colleges.
Yeah, but it's your job to provide the funding.
I understand.
So it's your job to provide the terms of and it's very clear in the guidance.
Indeed.
Alongside the guidance has been said, it was your job to provide that funding.
And that's the part that you and I played that role in saying we'll pay up to 13 months. The view of this committee is...
But why did you have to say that you would provide the 13 months? You could have just said, I'm not providing the 13 months. Because it's been over and above the recommended amount.
Indeed, I could have done that, but as we've said before, we took the view... We've taken the view that we wouldn't... damage the college and its ongoing arrangements. I mean, I accept there's a different view that I should have been more forceful and should have made that.
And forceful choice. Would have been what? What would forceful be?
Something like you suggest about a threat to fine the college or whatever. I have to say the context of the time was the mergers were voluntary mergers. We were seeking to persuade rather than to force. That was the tone
the
of all our discussions.
Door,
I apologise.
Well, you wanted these principles to move on, and this was a convenient process of, we provide this. But it was helpful that Mr. Doyle decided to go, was it not?
It's undoubtedly that merger would have been hampered had he...
Okay, Mr. Kemp, just finally, on the issue of, and sorry, my sight's not as good as it used to be, but looking at the table here, it's Langside College where there's a pension enhancement to the sum of £200,000 in that column. Now, there's no business case attached to that. So would you expect it to be a contractual arrangement where someone receives...
We understand that was a contractual arrangement. And again, that's something that we
find... Is that a civil servant contractual arrangement or a...
No, I think it was a Strathclyde pension scheme contractual arrangement.
Oh, but there was other boards who rejected... Apart, well, actually, the Coatbridge's case, they rejected it. So on what basis... Because I take it that... So you're clear that... So you're absolutely clear on the record today... There was no need for a business case to provide for that pension enhancement.
What I'm clear is there was no business case, and what I'm also clear is there was no requirement for them in advance to tell us they were doing a business case, or indeed to show us the business case afterwards. I'm answering your question in a very specific way because.
There's not provided about, no, but let's be clear, we don't have time to go over that. What the very clear issue here is a payment been made of £200,000. Now, all I'm saying is, the board, when they looked at this, are you saying to me that it was written in his contract that he would receive this enhancement, yes or no?
We understand that is the case.
Right, so is the case that he's pension enhanced, so on the basis of an early departure, then we have a specific reference in the contract that says you will receive... this sum plus the basics, the 13-month salary.
We understand that is the case, that this was a contractual right and that and it has been through the audit process. It would have been up within the board's gift to say this is a contractual right. If this person leaves, this has to go. We are not convinced that it is
that's
worth
a business
that.
Case would have come in, would it not?
Yes, yeah, indeed. Yeah. So and I completely accept
the point,
that point.
I think the point the committee have made on many occasions is, surely when all this public money is going out the door, then somebody has to say, yeah, you might have a contract in place, but you need to make a business case for enhancements. And that's always been said here. You know, we've asked for that information. It's become very clear. It's pretty haphazard. You know, I've been elected representative for 22 years. I've been to community council meetings. I've been to residents associations. And they have more in place and more effective monitoring systems to pay out very small sums of public money compared to this. Yeah. And I just can't believe that Scottish Funding Council, when they entered into this process, said £50 million, we'll make sure that every penny that's spent, to the best of our ability, has everything attached that it requires to be.
Case you refer to, we didn't pay the £200,000. Let's be clear on that. We paid an element of that.
Made the package.
Yeah, no, but I've accepted earlier, and I'll repeat again, that were it not for the Scottish Public Finance Manual, one of the lessons we would have learned is that the element which was out with our control in the control of boards is something that we would need more oversight of had we learned some of these lessons earlier.
Say in conclusion, this will be the last time that this committee will have the interaction with yourselves. We do thank you for your contribution, but we really do hope that given the robust report that we've put on record, and the recommendations that were made, we would like to think that the Scottish Funding Council, through your leadership, Professor Brown, would take on board the concerns that we've raised today and ensure that there's a legacy for the future, because this will come about again. There's no, there may be some other mergers or some other process that will come about that lessons are learned.
Convener, I can assure you of that.
Okay, thank you. Okay, colleagues, can I move on to agenda item number 4? Which is the Section 22 report, the 2014-15 audit of the Scottish Government's consolidated accounts. Colleagues will have on their desk the connected response from Alison Stafford, the Director General of Finance, on their desks. Do the colleagues have any comments? Tavi Scott?
Yes. Is this, convener, the response from the Permanent Secretary, Leslie Evans, in relation to consolidated accounts? And on the last, on page 5 of this report, there's a mention of the Common Agricultural Policy CAP Futures Project, which we've all been mentioning in passing today. I just wonder if we couldn't ask Leslie Evans for an update on this, because my understanding as of today is that this programme has still not paid out a quarter of the... paid a less than a quarter of the sums it should have paid out, There's no sign yet of any accelerated payments. And as Leslie Evans' letter says, it's already 74% over budget. And in addition to that cost, there are costs of extra staff that the Cabinet Secretary has already announced. And I think he's right to do that because the situation is such a shambles and it's a fiasco. So I just wonder if we could, in the next response we get from the Permanent Secretary, given the colossal amounts of public money being spent on something that is not working, ask her to be much clearer about what's actually going on here. I strongly appreciate that the Auditor General is also looking into this, and I strongly welcome that.
Ms. Callum.
Can I just support what Tavi Scott is saying? I had the pleasure of visiting Tavi Scott's constituency last week, and I heard, convener, that some of the staff from Shetland have actually been seconded to Edinburgh to help them to try and get this in order. So I think the costs that Mr. Scott makes about additional staff are well made. Can I also ask the question about how much additional costs it's going to take to be paid by instalments? And my third question, convener, is most of what we've been talking about in the Common Agricultural Policy payments so far has been the basic payments, which I understand were due in December. Now, I met five crofters in Shetland and none of them have had a penny of the money that was due in December. And what they're saying now is the main part of their funding is the less favoured area status payments, which are due in March. And what they're worried about is the domino effect, is that December payments still haven't been paid in the end of February. So the payments that were due in March, when are they due to be paid? And I can't go into the detail, but can I just say in terms of agriculture and crofting in Shetland, they stated very, very, very serious concerns about this cash flow problem coming forward. So I'd like to support Mr. Scott and to say we could do with considerable additional information before the end of this session on these payments, because it's causing real worry, but it's causing real hardship out there as well. Thank you.
Yeah, I'd like a bit more information on this charity arrangement with the capital projects. We've got a national charity. How do they ring fence local community benefit? How do we ensure that that portion of it goes back into that local community? It's not clear.
Okay, can we just be clear then in terms of the information that Tavi Scott is looking for? Tavi, can you just confirm what it is that you are recommending?
An update on the actual cost, which is supposedly 178 million. The additional costs that extra staff have been employed, which therefore must be a revenue cost in terms of staffing costs, and an update on the profile of when payments were made using this extraordinarily expensive computer that's not working.
Can you say, because obviously we don't want to duplicate the work of the Rural Affairs Committee,
so can we
just clarify with the committee, the other Rural Affairs Committee, what work that they've been doing in this, and if there is any duplication, then we can allow them to lead on that. But if there's areas that is relevant to this committee, then if we can leave it with the clerks to prepare accordingly. Is that
I'm saying the Rural Committee is not looking at the money, it's more just people getting
absolutely.
Paid.
Yeah, Richard Simpson.
Yes, we're dealing with the Lee Evans report.
Leslie Evans.
Leslie Evans. Yes, I mean, they answered some of the questions that I had. I think the same applies to the NHS IT procurement. We should be asking the Health Committee if they're doing anything on this, because there are issues around in terms of their previous reports that would indicate that things have not progressed. In 2010, the Health Committee had an inquiry into clinical portals and telehealth, and in paragraphs 47 and 48 of that report, they expressed concerns about developing multiple portals and the consequences of that in terms of functionality. In addition, they also questioned the issue around a single user identity, because that again led to considerable complications in the system. And I'm not satisfied that we've now got a new, I think it's 2012 to 2015, we've got some new policy or some new strategy on it. They were looking for a report in 2011-12. So can we ask them if they've actually done that, and it may be that they want to put it into a legacy paper to pursue this issue, because I think there is a general point as well that hasn't been answered, and that is after this morning's discussion, together with Leslie Evans's report, I have no clear idea of a pathway from the idea that we need a new IT system for something through to its completion. I just have no idea of that. And I think we should be asking the government and the information person in charge of digital or whatever it is. I mean, I don't know what all these people do, but whoever's right at the top of the procurement of IT across the whole government, we should actually have a much clearer pathway than we've got from the current structure.
Okay. Okay. I think we've got... Sorry, Nigel.
Thank you, Kevin. I'd just like to go back to what I think was previously being said about the charity arrangement in capital projects. I'm just wondering whether we could have a reasonably comprehensive briefing on just how this is supposed to work, because I think we've reached a point where they know what they're trying to do. Whether that comes from the government or whether perhaps it even comes from SPICE is not for me to say, but I think something that says lays out pretty comprehensively what we or our colleagues later need to know about this would be useful.
Okay. Please. Can we leave it with clerks to try and ensure that we don't duplicate the work of our committee, but that we take on board the points apart from that? Okay, as agreed, colleagues, we'll now move to the next agenda items, which are, as previously agreed, to hold in private.